Hello, you are welcome to Rabbi Class. This is not in any way a Jewish-oriented arrangement or initiative, as it may have sounded to you, but a midweek church service with an interactive session that can graduate to a debate kind of symposium that will accommodate even rival religious sects. This is that messenger that has a lot of explanations, a lot of answers to unanswered questions, that can reap, that can have. Most Holy Spirit, the God of the Spirit of the prophet, the God of divine revelations, the revealer of secrets, the giver of gifts, the supreme Lord of hosts, the Lord God of the heaven's armies, the corporeal and the incorporeal forces, the great cherubim and seraphim, the archangels and other angels, the ministering spirits, the citizens of the mansions also, the Godfather, the true Godfather of our heroic father, of our titan, our champion, our living legend, the very pride of the mankind race, the Godfather of the principal ancestor of the mankind race, His Eminence, King Adam, the God whose body has no reproach at all, the God whose handiworks or handcrafted works are unmatched masterpiece, the one and only true God Almighty, the God whose gene is a royal gene and the most royal gene, the God of pure hominids only, the God of gods, the supreme God King of the King of Kings, the God of kings and priests, the God of kings and priests, the God King of nobles, of royalties, princes and princesses, the God of the saints, the living God of the living, the source of life, the giver of life, the fountain of life, the life that is everlasting, the lifespan that never runs dry, the God that is self-dependent, self-sufficient, all-sufficient, without beginning or end, knowing the end of a matter from the beginning, the all-knowing, the almighty God, who alone deserves true worship, the God whom no one can kill, the God whom no one can feed, whom no planet can starve, whom no celestial or terrestrial kinds of planet, our grounds, water, or air, nourishes nor produces what he is, the God whom no one, no person, no individual can have to himself, whom no one can own or have or withhold what he is, whom no planet can host wholesomely or hold hostage, the God that is far, far beyond our rest, the God with whom all things are possible, the God that has no rival, the God that does not forsake any, especially those who trust or trusted in him patiently, the God whose help leaves no vacuum, the God whom nothing takes unawares, the God whose revelations are eye-opening and not eye-dulling, the God whose words are powerful, intoxicating, detoxifying, and dependable, the God among whose spoken words are found Eucharist, edible Eucharist, holy Eucharist, celestial life-giving food indeed, and not the achicha, or that terrestrial kind of bread baked with or without yeast, which can tear or break when bent, which houseflies can perch on, and can even breed insects or ants, the God whose words are supposed to be likened to ambrosia nectar, and not food for thoughts, but food for the spirit being. Pure hominid spirit being, precisely. The God who used or who uses celestial gold, so precious as that is, for flooring celestial planets outdoor. The God whose word moves mountains, whose reign of active revelations changes weather, conditions climate, weathers a storm. The God whose holy messages uninstall the perverse in any planet, chases away darkness in matrix stones at the echo, resetting the ecosystem of any terrestrial world gradually for the celestial to take over. The God whose word vanishes anarchy and chaos, frustrates the token of liars, making and proving their divinations baseless, that is without concrete foundation, lies and riotous, that is anarchical, cataclysmic or chaotic to cosmic methodology, formatting trends, thereby initiating changes positively. The God whose doctrines does not include casting of lot, the God who does not gamble nor do things by trial and error, The God whose word is living and active, whose word has microscopic properties, spiritual and life-giving properties. Spiritual meaning possessing spiritually genetic contents or properties, and life-giving simply meaning zoe hatching, life imputing, life imparting, life changing, life renewing, life immortalizing, life preserving, life polishing, powerful and surgically sharper or more piercing than any two-edged sword or surgical blade or blades or needles in life-saving operations. The God who speaks things into existence torrentially, calling them definitely and setting their order, and not in any way practicing optimism, faith, or being merely optimistic in his confessions. The God that has no birthday. The God whose source of life and power is himself, his spirit being, and not his word. But his word, his spoken word, has life or power because he's born of his spirit, is spoken by him. The God whose surveillance is all-encompassing, whose kingdom is all-sovereign, and never or can never suffer. The God that has his unmatched operation avatar, the master strategist, the extraordinary strategist, and transition programmer. I fear thee, the wiper out of the multi-generational reproach of the once stamped or tagged bastardized, the resurrector of the father of the people that were once called fatherless, the bail and resurrector of the principal ancestors of the mankind race, the defender of the widowed church, the ages the church ran without the husband of that church age, most loving father, most caring father, most model father, the God of the harvest, who sends laborers into his vineyard when the harvest is ripe, the supreme master builder of the church that conquered death. We worship thee, our super lover, our highest carer. Thy love does not die at all. Nothing dies or can die in thee, the supremely immortal God. Those wolves and monsters that said that thy love for mankind, thy agape for us, that thy agape are gapped from us by the sin or transgression of Father Adam, those anarchists are damned. Those wolves that called us poor banished children of Eve, those children of anarchy are damned forever. Truly, thy save is total. Thy save is total, O God of our salvation. Thy save is ultimate and homecoming, the lifter up of my head, meaning the resurrector of my principal ancestor, the promoter of my status, the grandest architect and master strategist, the avatar of my impending dangers. Genesis chapter 3, verse 17. And unto Adam he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife, and hast eaten of the tree of which I commanded thee, saying, thou shalt not eat of it. Cursed is the ground for thy sake. In sorrow shalt thou eat of it all the days of thy life. The correct rendition of this multi-millennial blunder will be out today. Thanks, most Holy Spirit, for teaching me and for leading us into this epochal truth about our costly procreation appreciation seed offerings and having to mark it globally as the carnival of carnivals, the God that do the impossible. I'm increasingly, ravishingly, and mesmerizingly in awe and humble admiration of thee, my God. I love and cherish thee deeply with the whole of me, with the entirety of my being. May we hear from thee once again in the simple or simplest language that we can understand. You will continue to reign forever, for thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. In the matchless name of our Supreme Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Hello. You are welcome to Rabbi Class. This is coming to you live from Lagos, Nigeria. This is not in any way a Jewish-oriented arrangement or initiative, as it may have sounded to you, but a live streaming midweek church service with an interactive session that can graduate to a debate kind of symposium, which will accommodate even rival religious sects over time. This is meant to provide answers to your unanswered questions and to prove the authenticity of the Holy Scriptures, prophecies of prophets penned down, proving that whole body of work to other religions of this world as true Why rabbi class? You may ask. Because it might not be a nursery class to those of you who are still kids in Bible studies, because of its in-depth, far-reaching, and spiritual nature. It is bone-cracking. It is myth-busting. It is truly rabbinical. Well, I will counsel you not to miss the episodes, as they are always epochal, versatile, and eye-opening. And eye-opening, that is the help that comes with it. Anything that is eye-opening, anything that opens your eye, is a helper. It helps you even when you cannot see because of some reasons. When you are not able to see what you should have seen, that is, that you need to see for your good, for you to become better, for you to know what you have, you didn't know, you know, and so on. What comes also, apart from the thing feeding you, the thing also is eye-opening. That thing is a helper. That was the reason for that. I still counsel you not to miss the episodes, because they are epochal. There is a way the messages that are coming has always been. They are not just some sort of some piece of information. They are not just those kind of learnings that you classify, or that you go to the schools, this school or that school, to learn. This is completely different. This is spiritual. This is for this is for your spirit being. And it's not just those things out there too that you can see them referred to as spiritual. And some of them, when you look at them, you read them, it looks a certain way. It has this nature of mysticism, you know, and so on. Not this kind. This is something that that is very, very precious. Very, very precious. I can assure you that. It is very good for your deliverance. Very good for your, I mean, for you breaking away from religious bondage. And the big one, the bondage of the mortal body, the fetters of the mortal nature, you see. It helps you to understand what the race is. It helps you to understand why do you even need to go to or belong to any church in the earth here. When you can pray, even from your house, while in your house, you can talk to the God, you know, with words like, where two or three of you are gathered in my name, I am there. Something like that. Why then do I have to go to any church? Why then do I go to a particular gathering place where a lot of people gathers that was called one name or the other? When I can, if I now have my wife or my wife and children, we are already more than two. When he say, when there's this place, that where two or three of you are gathered, I'm there. You see, now this helps you. This helps you with it, with revelations that are amazing, wonderful. Not what you will go to any bookshop to get any book that you find these things I'm talking about in them. And so on. You see, when you are a child of the kingdom, when you are a pure hominid, especially a heir or among the heirs of salvation, there is what these messages that are coming out are supposed to do. There is this way they should register in your spirit being. You hear this voice, you know that this is completely different. You hear this voice, you know that this is, I mean, the most Holy Spirit was telling me, just like amongst what was the latest that he told me. He said to me, he said, prophet, your messages, it's not just that they are amazing, but that the wisdom in them is what anybody that has very good reasoning in the earth will also see. The God himself, the most Holy Spirit, that's the Spirit of God, told me. He said to me, he said, prophet, your messages, your revelations, which he still is the one giving to me. But now, look at what he pointed out. Say to me, it's not just that they're amazing, but also that the wisdom in them, wow, I never saw it from that angle. He said to me, what was faked in somebody that was called Solomon, the son of David Jesse, which was, they didn't know that he was rather supposed to point to the son of the David of the mankind race. A certain son of the David of the mankind race, that what he will do was the reason for names like Jedidiah. What he will do was the reason for that aspect of being preferred in the midst of all the beloved, something like that.
For which reason, someone called John amongst the 12, also that same thing, that same phrase, you know, the beloved, came again. And he was called John, the beloved. And many, the others seem not to really like it, you know. Nobody will not want to be preferred. Nobody will not, I mean, nobody likes partiality, kind of. If we are 2, 3, 10, 20, and then someone was preferred, and you are not that person that was preferred. It is the preferred that we feel fine. But what about the others? You see, so my point is this, that the most Holy Spirit told me, he said to me, I mean, he commended the wisdom that it is something that anybody listening to the messages can see. That's what God told me. That anybody that is matured, anybody that is grown up, anybody that is like elderly, if I sound that way, someone who has very good reasoning faculty as well, that when he hears the things, my navigations, my explanations, you know, and getting this and the other and put it together, and how, I mean, the nuggets that I've been bringing out, that the person will also see what wisdom is like. That people use wisdom in the earth here because they have the literal version of that is the definition of wisdom. So that's why they always feel that, in fact, elderly people should have wisdom. And this has to do with the experiences that one has gathered, being that the person has stayed in the earth here for many years. So that person is supposed to be different, you know, have certain, like, have learned life's lessons, this life's lessons. Now, the God is saying that is different from the Bible wisdom. That's different from the wisdom that is the spiritual, the one that was referred to when they wrote about Solomon, for instance. That's still that wisdom that is different. You see, so the most of you told me, he said to me, that my teachings, aside the fact that he gives me these revelations, that the wisdom that is in me is also reflecting in the interpretations, in my interpretations of the revelation that he gives me. It was such a booster to me. You know, not boosting my morale, because my morale has never been less. I mean, has never been down. I mean, it was like you know, when you talk about, oh, how do I put it? Like an energy that is so positive coming on a charged field, kind of. You know? So it was just wonderful. It was not long that came to me. And it just made my day. I've been like swimming in the euphoria of that commendation, you know. It is so great. It's so great for me and to me when I hear from the Most Holy Spirit. It's just wonderful. That's just, God himself knows that it is not, it will not be easy for me if he should stop talking to me. If he should stop communicating to my spirit being. It's not what I can imagine. It's not what I will even wish any prophet. I wouldn't even wish that to any prophet. Where the Bible spoke about the spirit, where the Bible would have helped you to know what it means. That is what it means. The spirit of the prophet. The spirit of the prophet. You are a spirit being. You know. So the spirit of the prophet, that's a definition that would have come with that's on that to help you know who a prophet is. Because you are a spirit being, not the body. You are a spirit being. Your body is your body, is your physical body. So you're a spirit being means you are giving birth to spirit being first without physical body. And that person that gave birth to you is also a spirit being who is your super bio dad. You see, and that kind of birth took place somewhere. You see, but then what is the spirit of the prophet? That's why people didn't know that being a prophet has nothing to do with talent. they don't know that being a prophet has nothing to do with somebody being laid hands on. Then he becomes that. They don't know that it has nothing to do with somebody who got born again. And then at a certain point, God Almighty sends his spirit in measure, God's own spirit being in measure into the person. And then, you know, like, you know, gifts of the Holy Spirit. So to some he gave, to some he gave. So that's, so the person got prophesying as a gift, the spirit of divination as a gift. Oh, what a misinterpretation of something. You see, and the prophet has been still explaining to us that God is God himself is a person. And he has three different modes of operation. And that is something you should understand very well. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Most Holy Spirit, modes of operation. And that the God, the Most Holy Spirit, is that mode of operation that defines God's omnipresence and so on. The omni abilities of the God, like him being all hearing, can hear as many people as that are praying to him, let's say at the same time. Without having to listen to them, you know, like you like you listen to 20 people and you can tell them, no, like you can speak as one voice. Like this person says his own, the other person says hers as own. And that God who will listen, not as one person, but as many, that is to say, prophet said that such as pro-substantiation, that the God pro-substantiates from himself, spirit being from spirit being, physical body from physical body. And that is, when that happens, that's God the Son, mode of operation that you are about to see. That is if that's the end result of that, and that is the very God not in the capital size of God, the capital or total or full size of God happened to be the God, be God the Father mode of operation. That size is the size that God is in when he hangs planets on air. And the planet you can see, any planet you can see now, whether using a binocular, is terrestrial, is the kind that is not a heaven's world. That is to say, it is perishable. It is not supposed to last forever. Okay? And it harbors the system of death and so on. That's a different one. That one has to do with another kind, which when you see it, in fact, that one, so that's where you see the best of God. That's where you see the display of God's artistic skills. That's where you see who the God of creation, that's how the works of the God of creation is. You know, like when you see the work or the exhibition, the art is exhibitions of an artist, a good artist. You see, that's where you see God's own. Then the very God who will go inside that kind of a planet, that's a perfectly finished planet. That's nothing like death in it. There's nothing like rust in it. There's nothing like, that is the system of gradual, okay, dilapidation, name them, anything that has to do with spoiling, so is not there. Now, the God that will go inside the planet to now develop or to build, please forgive me, not develop, that's not the best language for that. I mean to build the infrastructures, there, like Revelation chapters pointed to, like mentioned, let's say streets, at least streets, and was talking about a heaven's world. Now, the God that will do those kind of works, and you have your houses, you will not stay inside a heaven's world, inside a planet, and you are not, you, there's no house. You just hang on air. No, it's not so, okay? All that you see in this kind of a planet is still a shadow in comparison to that one. You have your houses. Every child of the kingdom, every pure hominid, his name is already somewhere. And the number of the very people that belong to the mankind race is known. And they were not, creatures, actually. They were giving birth to, when it comes to the creatures, you talk about the cherubim and seraphim. Then you talk about the angels. These are free moral agents. They are creatures that are occupying different heaven's worlds. They are of a different race entirely. The angels are of their own race. The cherubim and seraphim are of their own race. You see? And then, and then mankind of his own race as well. Okay, so the principal ancestor of the mankind race happened to be the son that God gave birth to. He was giving birth to spirit being without physical body. All this took place in the Father's bosom. The Father's bosom is where God himself is. God does not live inside planets. His livelihood is beyond the lifestyle you talk about inside the planet. That's why he, look at, you see that wisdom. That's why you said that he is the one who hung the planets. He was the one who gave us lifestyles. He gave us our lifestyles. He was, okay, but even though in heaven's worlds, that's where you see it at its best. That's where you get to see that there's one language in every heaven's world. I mean, in the entire heaven's world, we have one language. Like the angels, they speak that same language in their own tongue, different tongues, but one language. One language, but different tongues. You see, multi-dialecta. That was the way. That was the time I would sound that way. Multi-dialecta. So they have their dialect and tongues. You see, the prophet said that heaven's world is not where you that is not where you speak different languages. You see, it's not a bilingualistic society. It is one language. And that was the language that Father Adam and Mother Eve spoke in the earth here. It got to the point, it got to the time of Noah. Noah spoke that language. You see, it was after the time of Noah, when one Nimrod, Cush, when he was here. That's when languages came. And that original one, that is the heavenly language, was withdrawn. Because angels, also the impure kind, has done one terrible thing already. That even threatened the very threatened the procreation of the mankind race, the multiplication that is still on. Okay, so what I'm trying to say here is that, you know, this very person is someone that you really must listen to patiently. Okay, justice has it. That you must listen to him patiently, like what is important to you, like you must give it that battle. That's how you treat what is important to you. The reason is because that is what, apart from you, him teaching you, there's much more that this will do. That if it has rounded up doing that, if it has succeeded doing that, you will be so grateful to God, and that is to say that in fact. The words in the Bible, like put on the whole armor of God, the way they wrote that, the helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, the shield of faith, the sword of the truth, and so on. Prophet explained that what that is. All of that was, you know, the real stuff is about fortification of the body, the armament of God. The way God fortifies the body is what that was supposed to be all about. And that prophet said that there's such as Eucharist, and that the Eucharist, what they call Eucharist today in the earth, is only a symbolic version of that, which has to do with terrestrial bread that was baked without yeast. That actually the real Eucharist is revelations that can hatch Zoe cells. You see, and that Zoe cells also being hatched has a particular number that it must get to. Then it has reached what is called her genome state, G-E-N-O-M-E, her genome state. And until it reaches that genome state, the main result, that is the end result, will not commence. And that end result, when it commences, is the launch into Jericho. That the race has to do with Gilgal, Bethel, Jericho, and Jordan. That these are four different metamorphoses, transcends of metamorphoses, positive metamorphoses, that every child of the kingdom, everybody that is born into this earth, that came into this earth through the womb of a woman, that is a pure hominid, that means he is putting on physical body that is mortal, has that race to run, has that transcends of metamorphoses to pursue, something like that. And that this is what even Jesus Christ was referring to, that will make him make comments like, what shall it profit you if you gain the whole world and loses your soul? He was pointing to the fact that your physical body that's supposed to be your greatest asset, your most high, that's your highest rated asset is your physical body, because when you lose that physical body, anything you must have owned, anything you must have achieved, you must have purchased that belongs to you, automatically you lose them. Automatically, because you become a ghost instantly. And so people of low wisdom, if I sound that way, they are not quick to catch this aspect because of things like, what about my children, my biological child, my, you know, and things like that. Okay, so but the, what I'm just saying here is that they you know, is that you should be able to know that in this planet, like you talk about treasures, precious stones, you see that there's this thing that suggests that you go for it, that you work for it, that you labor for it, you dig for it, things like that. Like, it's a law. What is so precious, so precious? It's not what you come out and just walking on the street, then you pick it. It's not what you stumble into. You don't really stumble into those kind of things. What made Jesus say things like, seek, ye shall find. Look at that. Then in a certain time, they wrote it as ask. They put ask first. Ask, you shall receive. Seek, you shall knock. You shall find. Then knock, it shall be opened unto you. But I prefer where he now helped you the more, and put it this way: seek ye first. That automatically corrected a certain setting, which put ask first. So people are quick to ask. And to them, asking has to do with what you need here. Oh God, I want to buy. Oh God, I need. Oh God, I need, and so on. Regarding that, God, Jesus Christ said, he knows what you need before you ask. He knows already what you need. He hung the planet on air. He made the water available in the earth here. He made the air available for you, the oxygen. He, and so on, okay? So he knows actually what you need. But notwithstanding, we all have that privilege to talk to the God, and he hears, okay? So the point is this, that when you look at words like, for thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory. The kingdom, the power, and the glory. You see that there are three. Then also look at that. Ask, seek, knock. Prophet said that the right arrangement of this ask of a thing, he corrected it when he said seek ye first. So you put seek as first. So you get seek, then you get ask, and then knock. Knock is the last. Now knocking has to do with the door that when you knock and it opens to you, it opens for you. Once you enter into wherever that you enters, it is forever. It is forever, something like that. So there are everlasting doors. I will explain this sometime. Everlasting doors. Different from the kind of doors you can find anywhere in the earth here. No matter how superior, no matter how good that door is, or even in the moon, then name them. It is completely different. In comparison to everlasting doors. You see, then also, like I said, that seek, ask, and then knock. You compare it with the kingdom. So seek ye first the kingdom. You see, seek ye first. So seek goes for the kingdom. Seek ye first the kingdom. Then he said, and every other thing follows. Then look, let's see, ask. Ask, we go for that. Because there's, like I told you, seek, ask, then knock. Then there is the kingdom, the power. Ask for what? The power. What does that mean? There is the kingdom authority. There is the kingdom authority. There is the kingdom authority. The power aspect that people have always loved, that aspect of diabolic kind of way of getting things, like achieving things and so on. That, is there anything I got that I can talk about that God said, referring to that? You get that in a certain place in the Bible, they wrote it this way. So once the Lord has spoken, something like that, twice I heard that power belongs to God. You see, now that power, P-O-W-E-R, this is not the message I want to explain to you today, please. I just mean here that seek goes, I mean that the seek ye first goes for the kingdom, the ask goes for the power, and then the knock goes for the glory. Wow. So let's leave that. I'm just telling you, child of the kingdom, I'm just telling you, pure hominid, that knowing who I am, knowing
that the most Holy Spirit speaks to me, incubates on me, sends me revelations, knowing very well what the truth is, knowing what it except is that way, except you eat my flesh and drink my blood, that was cannibalized. What when you want to say it, except which is except you assimilate revelations, except you eat the Eucharist. The Eucharist is like I told you, the revelations that you digest, you are able to. That's the Zoe hatching revelations that you are able to meditate to the point where you've digested it well enough. That is to say, I call that you bring it to the crystallization point or stage. Like when you are eating or chewing, you know, you digest, it starts from the mouth, guess it continues until, I mean, the food you're eating has to digest totally well. Then if it is carbohydrate, the body takes the starch from or glucose. Then if it is protein, amino acid. But the point is that it has to digest to a certain point before the body then absorbs it. That's what I mean here. You see? So that the revelations you must understand. Understanding is key. You can't meditate in what you have not yet understood. So meditating in something you have not understood yields no results. There is the fruit that the word bears. In the parable of the sower, I repeat, there is the fruit that the word bears in the parable of the sower. It was Jesus of Nazareth, his preeminence, that said that parable and interpreted it himself. Said that the very seed that the sower was sowing happened to be the words of God. He said that the grounds that are of different textures happened to be the hearts of human beings here. Then he said also that the fruits, did you see? That the very seeds sown, that is the words that went through, that went in, has what it hatches, what it brings forth. And later he gave them folds. Said a certain one, he gave it 30 folds. A certain one, he gave it 60 folds. Then a certain 100 folds. But because it was not totally interpreted well, like in writing, so the people didn't still get it. Okay, and also the likes of those good deeds, they've always given that to the fruits of the counsels, fruits of the advices, fruits of the words that a preacher, sermons a preacher will preach. That's why you see some people say, hey, please, please, don't preach to me. Keep your sermon. Because they feel that the best you can get from whatever a preacher has to say has nothing to do with cells being hatched. But I'm telling you that there is a reason Jesus wants to make comments like, the words that I speak to you, they wrote it as, they are spirit and life. They are spirit and life. Look at it yourself. If words somebody saying to you can be spirit and life, it was incomplete. What he said was, it is spiritual and life-giving. The words that I'm speaking to you, he was telling the people, certain people, I mean, these apostles, I am sure that even though they are in Abraham's bosom doing certain works there too, I know that they will not be very proud of themselves. If that's during their resurrection, they won't be very, because they, for me, the rarest privilege is to sit with this God, to hear from this God who knows your ability, as he knows your in gene ability. That is to say, like he knows your spirit being, not your body now. The best, the limit when it comes to the virtues that your spirit has, the abilities your spirit has. And he will not expect from you what your spirit cannot, that has not that ability to do. So I understand that God also, who is a helper, that is who can tell you that this so thing is possible, not banking on your own ability to make it possible, but in his own ability, the almighty ability, who can make what is not possible to become possible. Jesus was touching it when he was in a certain scenario, that's to do with someone, that he said a certain, the way they wrote that, and the person has reasons to go frowning, something like that. Then they wrote that he now said that it is very difficult for a rich man. Or in fact, they wrote that he said that it is easier for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to go to heaven the way they wrote it, something like that. But what he said was, if you look at that, it looks like it was, in fact, no rich person financially will like that side of the Bible. Chai, it was looking like then you want to go to heaven, then you have to be poor financially. That was not in any way what he meant. Oh, God of mercy. What that was pointing to has to do with the fact that, first of all, that what is impossible when it comes to human beings here and their ability, their different abilities, what is not possible when you judge by looking at not just their flesh, even not just their physical body that is mortal, even their spirit being, what, you know, when you talk about, when you call, that's, I mean, potential abilities, that it is not so when God is involved. That's the reason for that with W-I-T-H. With means there are two people or two parties, not one person. He said, but with God, all things are possible. Or when his apostles were like grudged a little, like, who then? He said, not with, but not so with God. For with God, all things are possible. So he was pointing to something that has to do with not just you having your own role to play. God Almighty has his own role to play in that. Like what? Like me bringing the revelations to you. Now, the God is the one who incubates upon my spirit being. You see, the spirit being, like I was talking about the spirit of a prophet. In a certain place in the Bible, they wrote something like, he said, the spirit of man, something like that. For the spirit searcheth for. Something like that. For the spirit searcheth for the deep things of God. Now, that for the spirit searcheth for, they didn't write it well. Because there are different spirits. It is talking about the spirit of those that are in the mankind race. Then, to be more specific, the prophets. So it can be referred to as the spirit of the prophet. Such it. It's like an antenna. It's like a signal receiver that can also be a signal searcher. Signal searcher. You see, that's if there is signal, there is that thing that will help that antenna to dictate it. Then when it is not so, that is when there is no signal, there is also that thing that will help that, like antenna, to dictate it. That's why, like, you watch your television, you see that the decoder that is inside, and then the dish that is outside, there's a situation that can make the decoder write for you, to write on your screen, no signal. You see? That means there was a searching that didn't succeed. So my point is that the spirit of the prophet is yet to be understood, is yet to be known in this earth. That was why people do abuse them. Apart from the fact that many that were false did all sorts that many today are skepticals, skeptical or skeptics when it comes to prophets and what they do. They rather will even have less of that, those skeptics, those that doubt, if they face witch doctors who do what they call divination. That was why Saul Paul, or an example again is Saul Paul, trying to redefine that. You see, which is what the Pentecostals, as they are called today, are trying to take to be when you are born again, you know, which has to do with receiving what Jesus Christ came to do, and that the death of Jesus is remembrance is what paid the price for you, for the sin that you inherited, or sin nature that you inherited, and also the consequences of that you inherited, just because of one person that offended the very God. And we were still the God who molded the person and molded his wife for him. Things like something like that. And the God was so angry that what the God was meeting out for him was not just for him and that his wife, but for both their children. And he still took that God very long time before he now sent his son, Jesus Christ, like they wrote or they interpreted to you. And that was exactly what is called rituals, that the Son of God was referred to as the Lamb of God, and that Lamb of God was supposed to be the Son of God, and that Lamb of God simply means somebody that God gave birth to and later sent to come and be killed, and his blood being shed and so on is what will atone for the sin of one Adam, his eminence, okay, and Mother Eve,
which was not just that they disappointed the God, who they told me that he can see what will happen before it happens, who they told me that he has what is called logos, what he mapped out before he start bring, let's delve into action. As I mean, like people will have a design of a house first. Architects will tell you that. How can you start building a house? You don't know the design. You don't know how you do. I mean, what about the foundation? The foundation of a house is determined by the size. That is, if you want to build a bungalow, for instance, that's like a story, a house on the ground, that is not the one you put on top of another. The foundation you lay there might be different from when you want to build the one that will have one again on top of the one down. If you want to build another one that is two on top of three, if it's not very tall, the foundation must be as strong to be able to carry that building. How was it that there are angels, there are cherubim, seraphim, and so on? And even the Bible did not even explain the anatomy of these beings, like the angels. The anatomy. The best the world knows today, it has to do with angels having two wings. And that's why they can put the two wings on human beings. That is somebody that is standing like this, two hands, five fingers on each, two legs, five toes on each, then with two wings at the back. That's an angel. That's the image of an angel. You see, whether it's male or female, does not matter. Then when it comes to the cherubim, that is the one that the best you can also find in the Bible is that it has six wings. That God told Moses, you should make the image of a cherub or two cherubim. They even put S where they wrote that, cherubims. Meanwhile, cherubim supposed to be plural. Cherub supposed to be one. They put it that way to show the level of the illiteracy. When it comes to supernatural realities, oh my goodness. The most Holy Spirit told me so. I mean, his commendation is such a, I mean, I love it. After the program I held, that is first October program, which was this last Sunday. You know, just after that, he came. I mean, he told me that. The wisdom in the message is so far that there is a wisdom, aside the revelations, that there's a wisdom. That somebody who is also wise, we see that. And he linked it to the son of David that at a time you were not just talking about that son of David as somebody who inherited a kind of kingdom, but somebody that was gifted with wisdom, something like that. He was telling me how that it's left for that people to know if truly that person is that Jedidiah, if that person is that son of the David of the mankind race. God is impressed. Imagine, God is impressed by what I do. If you are me, how will you feel? You see? So what I'm trying to say here is that you should be able to have that time to listen to this prophet. He gives you these messages, not following the rudiments of this world. He gives you these messages, not following how people tag prizes when it comes to what they do, what they are doing, especially that has to do with also rendering services that will benefit human beings here, and so on. He is not going about it that way. Or looking at what he deserves to get from you, he's not going about it that way, and so on. You see, so it is as he does it this way that he does it. You see this message, many of them, even in the YouTube, you see many of them there. Okay, you should make sure, for the sake of the law of justification, that he himself is not. He is not the law of justification. The law and the prophet can be a personification of that statute, kind of. What is pointing to equity? What is pointing to the fact that there should be justice and not in that injustice is injustice? Just like somebody wrote that he believed in the God that justifies the ungodly. And that was written. What Jesus promise came to do, that was misinterpreted grossly by the apostles, Peter and co, has really, really not helped matters at all. No wonder they suffered martyrdom. No wonder when there are angels, archangels, trained seriously by Father Adam, explained a whole lot of things. Kingdom matters, prophesied. Father Adam is the greater than the prophet. So told them certain things, told them when they are even needed the most, and so on. You see, yet it was terrible. If you should be if it should be revealed to, how, for instance, the likes of Apostle Peter was murdered, was martyred. His brother Andrew, these are two brothers, two biological brothers. Imagine if you are the mom of these two children, two sons. What will you say? See, martyrdom is terrible. And when you are martyrdom, it's not just about being killed. Because some people say, after all, people die. Like, after all, everybody dies. Something like that. Martyrdom is not just being killed. The way and manner the person was killed is what you should ask in this aspect, in this regard. It was terrible. If you should enter into the hands of your enemies, the hands of people that hated you, not just you as a person, like hated your race, hated your lineage, hated your principal ancestor, something like that. It is terrible for you to enter into the hands of such people. And I decree that you will never be a victim of martyrdom. In the matchless name of our Supreme Lord Jesus Christ, I make this decree. So please, because I have always had a lot to explain. Like I touched the Trinity. I didn't finish explaining it because I've always touched it. God the Father is the God in his capital size. And in him dwells the fullness of the Godhead. You will not find this in your Bible. What you find in your Bible is that in Jesus Christ's remains dwells the fullness of the God, of the Godhead. Jesus Christ's remains is a fraction of the God. He prosubstantiated from the Father. Very true. He has gone back to his fatherhood state. Jesus Christ is the God in an incarnate manifestation. A lot that he did here, he did when he came through the womb of Virgin Mary. In the shoes of the Son of God. In the shoes of the Son of God. In the shoes of the Son of God. It's not the same with the person being the very Son of God. Procreation has to do with the multiplication of human beings here. That came with a price, a very costly price. This is one of the things I'm explaining to the global community of Christians. Procreation has to do with the multiplication of the human race. But then the physical bodies that got coupled, people didn't know that those physical bodies are perfect and supernatural kind. They cannot, that system of, that is like a seed, except a seed dies, it abided alone. Which is to say, when they talk about planting, sowing seeds, then also the ground where that seed will do that it will die. So that ground must be tillable. That ground must be a certain way, okay? Now, and also the seed itself must be something that can die. The seed should be something that can die. If it cannot die, how will it grow? I mean, how will it begin to, you know? So it is like it's dying and dying. That system is also where the growing of that, becoming a tree, is in. That's how it is. The physical bodies of the male and the female kind, which the spirit beings also, the spirit being of the son that God gave birth to, was mimassed into the male at a time. First, after which the spirit being of the female version of that, which also the world didn't know how that spirit being then, where would it have come from? If you said that, like a prophet said last Sunday, said that that who would have revealed to him? That Lucifer at some point also at a time said, on account of the fact that he is the son of God, Mother Eve then is the daughter of who? Look at that. That this was amongst what Lucifer said. Now, is either I said what I said now is true or is a lie. If it is true, I tell you that this very earth, her cosmic laws as well, the sun, the moon, the stars, the rotation of this earth, this very planet, around her own axis and around the orbit of the sun, the laws that are that has to do with the foundation of this very earth that I'm inside must at a time, I tell you, pay obeisance to my sheaves. If these things that are coming out in a situation, in a condition where, if you should look at things documented by historians, you talk about the media, talk about name it, different handles, arms of whatever that is that you point to, that has that play serious role in keeping like a dossier of information. Name them. There is not any that supplied me. There's not any that feeds me with what I'm bringing out. You see, if it is so, I tell you, then that this particular earth But I'm still explaining how that the God that hung the very earth, the God of creation himself, who hung this earth, the herbs in her, it was the God that was the or is the harbor of the very herbs, that this very earth must respect, must. That's what I mean by that pay obeisance, because nature is not a respecter of persons. They wrote God is not a respecter, which is not true. God is a respecter of persons. Let me tell you, God is so respectful. When it comes to virtues, oh, you need to meet this God. I mean, if he should be not just prosubstantiated, but also transubstantiated. That is, if he should come, this, that's just like he came to Abraham. Abraham heard him. He is a bank of virtues. When you say courtesy, things like that, he is such a courteous person. In his style of walking, just walking alone, you see there. He's such a personage. The best. By far, 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 far. You see, beats all in everything called virtue. Beats all. There's nothing that you will want to, you feel like you can come and come to him to correct him in. His manner of speech. And so on. Then I'm telling you that this character, I explain now, has suffered a lot of assassination in this earth. Assassination of character. That is not, it's not just, I mean, both in writing. what was written in what was written on paper or electronically. You see, I'm so happy that I'm in the air today. I'm so happy that the darkness of this world, that I know how xenophobic it is to me, that I know how xenophobic it is to my physicalization, my manifestation physically, which is still on, because the me I refer to here is the spirit being, which is not one yet with the physical body I have. So there's a like a hypostatic union or unism between the spirit me programmed in the soul that was amassed into this physical body that I'm wearing, that formed in my biological mother's womb in a size that is so small compared to the size of the spirit being. But I understood what squatting is and why Naaman squatted 7 times inside water, only him. That one is completely different from baptism. And that is not a routine to follow in terms of healing the leper or healing anybody. I understood that. So I mean that I am explaining a lot to people. I'm explaining a lot to people in this planet Earth here with a lot of patience as well, knowing what it means to serve God, knowing what it means that it is God that I'm worshiping and not human beings. You see? And so I'm only counseling you so that the law of justification, the law that ensures that everything that God, the God of justice, the God who is such a judge, that everything that has to do with his judgment was found like fastened up on a beacon that you can refer to as the beacon of justice. You are either of justice or injustice. Nobody likes to suffer injustice. Nobody likes to suffer injustice. So there's a whole lot that I came not to prove, like what you wrote was written in the Bible. I didn't come to condemn them. I didn't come to prove that they are wrong. Not exactly. I came to make them, I mean, to explain them better. I came to explain them better, to make you understand things that were written, but they were senseless. They were, some didn't even, some even are mad. Some has to do with blasphemies, trying to stain the image, the most immaculate image of this God. Okay, and so on. So that when you listen well, you will see it for yourself. You will see that I'm not just trying to trample upon people because I want to climb up, like many do. That's not what I'm doing. Okay? And by the virtue of what I do, who I am, my identity, you can even discover if you are just listening to me, listen to what I do, following what I do, and seeing also some things written in the Bible concerning somebody who, when he will come, will do that. You see? So, because I have genuine love for you, because I know what the truth is, and I know that you, as a pure hominid, immersed into the body you have now, that there's a situation. I don't think I will prefer you to have gotten to that point where your body ejected your spirit being, programmed in the soul, out. That means you become a ghost. Then you now realize that will not make me happy. You see, I know that the only way you can please God is by expressly immortalizing. Why will that not also be what pleases my spirit? When I claim I am sent by this God of justice, God will not send somebody who has not even a passion, or who has not passion in what pleases him the most. God will not send somebody who is careless, reckless, who is lackadaisical when it comes to attitudes of handling things. Someone who doesn't really care, you know, to come and to handle something that is so important to the very God. God loves you like a father. I mean, biological father. We love his own child. It means he's not the kind that is at the mercy of even wrongdoings. Like, there's a genetic connection there. You see, so I'm only explaining things to you because there are the laws. God is not a breaker of law or any law. His actions set laws. You see, you should understand these things, right? So, like I said, I would really like to go straight to today's topic, please. When prophet prayed, he said this. Genesis 3:17. And unto Adam he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife, and hast eaten of the tree of which I commanded thee, saying, thou shalt not eat of it. Cursed is the ground for thy sake. In sorrow shalt thou eat of it all the days of your life. Now, when you look at this very well, you will see that, first of all, that it made the very God look like someone that something was taken unawares, that something took unawares, you know. Even from that Adam, where are you? That was pointing to the, like, you could have asked, I thought God is all seeing. Why that Adam? Like, where are you? Like, I cannot find you. I cannot find you. Something like that. Where are you? And then the very person, until he spoke out. Then when he did, it was now, we had to hide from the God. That is to say, they believe that they can actually hide from God. Did you see? It was pointing to that all-seeing, being that he was blaspheming the name, the all-seeing God. The God that, oh God, I hope you are getting this. So then what the second one has to do with somebody who is feeling guilty because that he has done something that God said he shouldn't do. And again, also, it was pointing to the fact that the man was such a weakling beside the woman. That the man was under the influence of the woman's body. So that the man did whatever because he was already falling for the woman. Kind of. And also another one has to do with how that they were naive before the fall. They were in a naive state. So, because they were naked, as in not wearing anything, walking about not wearing anything, but didn't know that they've been naked. So that it was now the serpent that was wise enough to say certain things to them, or to the woman who hearkened to the very serpent, ate from what they wrote that God said you shouldn't eat from. And what happened after she ate from that tree was just one thing, which they wrote as, and her eyes opened. And the opening of eye is a positive metamorphosis. There are positive energies and negative, if you understand that. Opening of an eye that must have been the kind that would not notice or see what he was supposed to see. Just like, for instance, a child that was being naked at a time. Then at a time, the child grew to the point where the child started seeing, no, I shouldn't cover myself. What will you call it? Growth. What is growth? Is growth positive or negative? Now, the eyes of them both were opened. And they realized they've been naked. That's the way they wrote that. So they've been naked all the while, but they didn't know. That was the reason for that. Their eyes opened. So they realized, because their eyes has opened, they realized they've been naked. Did you see? And then, of which reason they were hiding when Father Adam heard the voice. Oh, God of mercy. Oh, what a situation in the earth here. What a situation of bondage. What a situation that can keep a people down. Oh my God. What a situation of ignorance. A height of ignorance. You see, my dear, what I'm saying here is this. That they didn't write that well at all. What was written in the New Testament, that's as far as the journey got to that place. That was when that word, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Tell me how, and their eyes opened. Agreed with that. Meanwhile, and for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God was pointing to the action of Genesis 3. It was pointing to the action of Genesis chapter 3, which has to do with the woman and the serpent. That's what was written there. As according to them, that it was uttered by Moses. Did you see? And then, that was the foundation of that whole thing that's with the sin. God being angered and then meted out punishments. And one of what came was death. So what they now said that the solution of all of that was founded upon what? The crucifixion of Jesus of Nazareth, His Prime Minister. That was terrible. My dear, if you know what rituals are, if you know what, when it comes to rituals, what it is, what both blood that will cleanse sin was misunderstood. Moses didn't help matters at all. As that animals also, before the very New Testament, you know, those things that were happening, that they said, like, in fact, there were trickles of that, anyway, because they still wrote that Noah did his. And that Noah, in fact, what he sacrificed, what he was roasting, nourished God so much that he has to change what he said before. Meanwhile, they had written that God is not a man that he should lie, nor is he the son of man that he should repent. It's not always easy for me to like say them like what I've had inside me. Please, so forgive me. I really, really don't even want to have them inside me. So truly, I really do think to say it, because I've always said, you know, I mean it's like it's in the brain. That's what I mean. I don't get it inside. That's why it's not always what, at times I may not even quote exactly the way they wrote it, because they are wrong. They are blasphemies. I am telling you. God, let me sing this song. What I said was, or is, you can never, never change. You can never, never change. He can never, never change. They put it, Jesus, the same forever. You can still go. They, God, is same forever. Or God is the same forever. My dear, look at that. If God truly can never change, how would they explain it? Does he still eat sacrifices today? Okay, his own son that was hanging on the cross and in that condition satisfied that. So who is he? Why will you explain that the character of that person? And they wrote that the very son also entered into the most holy place with his own blood, the cup of his blood. Where is that place? The blood in question is the blood that is liquid, that you know. Liquid blood that is red in color. Where would that blood go to? Is it where ghosts go to? Or where when he has resurrected, he went to? Even when he has resurrected, Judas, they wrote that Judas, please forgive me, they wrote that Thomas was even demanding for scars, holes of where he was pierced, so that he will believe is him. Why will you explain that? What is resurrection? If that will be there, so the resurrection of people that were shot, that has bullet wounds, if they resurrect, that means they will also come up again with that same wound. That means you can also ask them, you were the one that was, oh, please, I want to see where they shot you. What I'm trying to say is this. There is a whole lot that was misinterpreted. I am telling you the truth. And this affected the church in this earth as well. The global recognition, reputation, respect that the church, as in a people that God is with. You know what that means? My God and my God. Do you know what deity means? Do you know what oracle means? Oracle. Do you know what it means to be a custodian of divine informations? Revelations from the God Almighty reflects his wisdom as well. His own infinite wisdom. Reflects his many-sided wisdom. Reflects his integrity that is unmatched. And so on. Where is that today? Tell me. Where is that today? You don't have to be too busy when it comes to things like this. You don't have to be too busy when it comes to what if you should go to where ghosts go to. Looking at the time you spent here and the time that awaits and what you did here can determine for you. There is a way to go about it. Don't you think so? So, like I said, what they wrote in Genesis chapter 3, verse 17, has a lot in it that was not written well. God's name was blasphemed. The name that was blasphemed here is not the God of creation. The one that blasphemed the name, the God of creation, is, for instance, Charles Darwin, who told you that everything that you are looking at, or mankind, originated from what he called evolution, and pointed a lifeline, an ancestry lineage, and to you, amongst which you find apes, A-P-E-S, apes, that has their own family, apes that has not a language, apes that, as I'm talking with you, they can't even take a good bath. They are not thinking of anything that has to do with manufacturing, with producing, and so on. Apes that are so ugly. Apes that that's what Charles Darwin. I mean, feeling nothing will happen. Who is an agent of Lucifer? Who is an agent of this certain rebel group? Six cherubim and one seraph, which happened to be the seven heads of the beast. Written in the Revelation in Revelation chapters, that has been behind a lot that has been happening in this setup, and many didn't know. Masquerading in secrecy, shrouding in secrecy, and deliberate cover up behind the martyrdom of many saints. And you still didn't know. And you still didn't know. Child, you see, my dear. Jesus Christ is preeminent. Ezuteziokwe relaya, ezioko bondwe, ezuteziokwe relaya. Ezioku bondue, izu tezioku erelaya, ezioku bondue, izu tezioku erelaya, ezioku bondue. Buy this truth and sell it not,
This truth is life-giving. Buy this truth and sell it not. This truth is eye-opening. Buy this truth and sell it not. This truth is life-giving. Buy this truth and sell it not. This truth is life-giving. God, the God of the spirit of the prophets, has the mode of operation that when he operates that, it defines further. It defines further how that he can handle many things. How that he can see as many places as he wants to see. How that he can hear as many people as he wants to hear or listen to. Nothing takes God unawares. He can go into the future, into a future that is yet to come, to work on, to fix, or to avert what will happen that is dangerous for you. To make crooked paths straight points to this. The God that can predestine those whom he foreknew. What does that mean to you? There is also what is called conforming to a prototype image. There's a prototype image. What image do you understand to be the prototype when it comes to the transfiguration of everybody in the mankind race? If not the physical body, God himself coupled. One male physical body, not two. The female one, I mean one male physical body, one female physical body. That's the only physical body that God coupled. And it is not in baby size. It's not in baby size. God coupled that physical body in a particular size that you should know that there was not written in the Bible. It was not written in the Bible you have now. If you understand what it means to conform to an image, look at the word conform. To conform. Because as there will be transfiguration. Elijah of Tishbe across Jordan. Transfigured. Transfigured means left from a stature, a particular stature, to another stature. It couldn't have been possible if God didn't do something. That was what it was called predestined. It was whom he foreknew, he predestined, so that they will conform to the image of somebody. That physical body that God coupled, where do you think it is today? Under the ground? Under the earth, as one of the things that these archaeologists can find in pieces. That physical body that God coupled is a masterpiece and of inestimable value. You know what it means? Inestimable value. It means there's no price you can tag on it. You cannot say this is the cost. If you like gold can be weighed. And then we say this is the you know that that's this translation in currency. Oh, thank you, most Holy Spirit. That's the word. It cannot be translated when it comes to currencies. You is beyond it. The very material that was used to couple that physical body, that they said that is dust, and that God himself said also that is dust, it is not true. I am telling you the truth. They didn't tell you the truth. The matter that what has to do with the church at a time, the enemy of the church hijacked the very church and also did certain things and allowed certain things to be what will go, what will be allowed for circulation, global readership, for public readership. I came to save a situation. I am not just a sent one. I'm the kind they refer to as the messianic kind. If you listen to me very well, you will see this for yourself. As in, it's not like people don't like it when somebody talks about himself in this after this manner. But I choose to tell you everything that God expects me to tell you, without thinking of such things. My yieldedness should be 100/100. Part the will of God
in its totality, perfection, in its entirety, is what I said yesterday concerning you. Me as a free moral agent, I kept all of mine by the corner. Anyway, I don't sound like I'm doing something like somebody who was deprived of his this and not in an angle, please. What I mean here is that the will of the God is so beautiful that it swallowed mine. That's what I mean. I couldn't have said yes to something better. What rather I saw that is his perfect will is the best. You see? So you should understand this. God loves you so much that he's not pleased with maggots feasting in your body. He's not pleased with bacteria, parasites, fungi, virus feasting in your body. It doesn't entertain him. He's not pleased with that tortures you go through when the body is dying. It doesn't entertain him. He is not entertained by that those kind of things. God is 100% holy, righteous to the core. Is his nature. That is his nature. He wants you to know him because it will help you to understand certain things that they tried rubbing on him that is not true. Like I said, God can see what will happen before it happens. If it is not so, why are there diviners in your earth? If God himself is not somebody who can see what will happen before it happens. That they wrote in the Bible, in your Bible, that he was even calling those two people like Adam, like, where are you? Look at that yourself. It simply is what somebody who is not all seeing will do. Because he didn't know where they are. I have to explain to you what was written there. They didn't write it well. He was talking about the level of metamorphosis, negative metamorphosis, that is in the fall that they are already. And he was not asking, like, where are you? He was like, hope you know the level you are on now. Why? There is where if they get to and didn't vacate the very heavens world, that's what will happen. Did you see? Also, that being naive, that is to say, like a child who may be naked or can be naked but not know, because the child is yet to know even why he or she needs to cover the so-called body of theirs. So that's why they can be comfortable or fine without wearing anything. That is not true. It's not true. You need to understand that place where that Eden, that is actually a heaven's world, and also understand that's fashion or outfits in heaven or heaven's worlds. How do people dress in heaven's worlds? If there are angels, what cloth are they wearing? What happens to the cloth? Does it get dirty? Who made the cloth? Were the cloths sewn by a tailor in heaven? Do they wear one cloth forever? How do they change those clothes? If there are cherubim and seraphim, what cloth are they wearing? Or they don't need to wear cloth? And if you have to understand that, to be able to understand the status that they are also in that wise, in that Eden. Like Jesus of Nazareth is resurrected. When he resurrected, which cloth was he wearing? When he went up, what did he go with that cloth? Is he still with that cloth now? Who will give him another? How will he change that cloth? Or will he just be in that with that cloth forever? Where did he get that cloth from? Is that cloth what can tear? What's the color of that cloth? You need to know these things, my dear. That was why Jesus Christ, one of the things he said to the people looking at him when he has resurrected was, touch me, I am not a ghost. G-H-O-S-T. I am not a ghost. He didn't stop there. A ghost has not physical body, as you see me have. The level of them not knowing these things I said now, I'm explaining, still affected what they wrote. They still wrote it. A ghost has not flesh and bone, as you see me have. Flesh is body that can tear. Flesh is body that is beefy. Flesh is body that is beefy, and that can tear. Razor can cut it. Jesus can mess it up. Fire can melt it. Name it. That's not the kind of body that he came up with. That is, he came up with. Because that body has immortal life cell system. Immortal cell kind is what built that body. You should understand the supernatural body, what that is. To understand that if any man be in, they put Christ. What is supposed to be there is, if any man be in the transfigured state, if any man be in the transfigured state, he is a new creation, a new creature. That was what they wrote. Mankind, the relationship between God and mankind is not creator-creature relationship. It's father-son relationship. So what should be there is what? He is a new creation. No, he is a new, a brand new person. All things have passed away, and all things have become new. Was pointing to the, how that the old body and her organisms, internal organs, and so on, and the systems are completely changed. Like there is the respiratory system of the body you have now. Because of the respiratory system, the way it is, you must breathe in oxygen and breathe out. It's a must. If no matter how the blood is in your body now, that is fine. I mean, that is the that's the quantity of blood is okay. The food you ate well. If you lock your nose and not breathe in oxygen for a certain number of time, you'll be amazed what will happen. You see. Now, my dear, that kind of life is at the mercy of things like that oxygen that you breathe. It's at the mercy of even being inside a place where they throw tear gas inside there, or they sprayed something that is now terrible, that can suffocate, not suffocation, please, like that can choke the person. So the person, even though that thing is bad, the person cannot help it, because if he ceases to breathe, it's only for a period of time. He must breathe. And then when he breathes in, that goes in and is killing him. You can see. So that is not a system of immortality. It can't be a system of immortality. An immortal cannot be somebody who is breathing oxygen, earth and her people that are staying in her. An immortal person cannot be somebody who is breathing in oxygen, because oxygen finishes, that's a problem. If the person is inhaling anything that is terrible, that's a problem. Prophet, are you then saying that Jesus promised, like when he resurrected, he was not breathing? How is he alive? If you think you can only be alive if you are breathing. Your spirit being, before it was immersed into the physical body you have now, is not breathing. It doesn't need to breathe. Does not need to breathe in oxygen. That is my point. And breathe out something. It's not supposed to be so. See, the spirit, God is self-eternal, self-dependent, all-sufficient, self-sufficient. That will help you to know the son he gave birth to, how he is. Like begets like. But that son was given birth to spirit being without physical body. It will help you to know why I point to the spirit being, you. So the physical body you have now is not yet one in it's not yet one in terms of elements. The spirit being is different. That body of yours was built by what your biological dad used to fertilize, or the semen that fertilized the egg in your mother's womb, biological mother's womb. And the building of that body, where it started from, the first male body that formed in the womb of Mother Eve was Cain, Cain's body. That took after the image or the copy that I call unoriginal copy. So the image before the fall and the image in the fall or after the fall is not the same. So there was not the transfiguration is because there was a disfiguration. There was a shrinking. There was a shrinking from a certain height that happened to that physical body, those physical bodies. And what they told you, that it was their eye that opened, then they realized they have been naked. They didn't write well. It was a strip off, STRIP, a strip off, 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 OF, immortality and celestial glory from that body. That was what happened. So there was an alteration of the cell system
of that body that got coupled.
This is what God loves this so much when I'm explaining it this way. Because I didn't have to read it in any book. There was a strip off. You see, it wouldn't have been enough. That's why I went for that to explain to you. There's such as the cell system of that physical body. So there was an alteration. This one will help you to know what it means. When I say things like setting an altar, do you know what people turned it into today? And they thought it's putting tablecloths on a table, candles here and there. The advancement that is happening to the earth is already facing out candles. Did you see? And so on. They don't understand what it means to set an altar. Yet English has what is called to alter something. That is different from putting candles and putting tablecloth. So Father Adam had to set an altar and then initiate or bring the alteration of the cell system of the physical body that got coupled. Which prophet said, it's just like a car that has already been built, that is moving, that has its gear, right? The person that is the driver, taking the gear and putting that gear from the movement that is forward, positive, all right, to the reverse. That's what it's like. So the same energy was reversed. That was what happened. So what was supposed to mean positive metamorphosis meant negative metamorphosis. If I should sound this, that's if you look at metamorphosis now. But my point is that, like, that physical body that got coupled cannot age. Cannot. Not does not. Cannot age. The bodies of the angels in the original, okay, state, cherubim, seraphim, they don't aging. See, aging in heaven's world is actually unreal. Like, they wonder, what are you talking about? Until they saw that, like, this kind of a planet, you know, was brought into tangible reality, and life in her, looking at the animals, fishes, birds, and so on, okay, and especially when that action of the action of the four took place, the terrestrial foundation was set. So that life that gradually fades, that was them seeing it. That was how angels, like, they can come into this planet. Yeah, when it comes to the heaven's worlds, you don't even talk about dust. See, you know how, for instance, somebody is walking on the road, you know, the person can just do like this, like, and it's normal, or do like this, or, you know, and it's normal, like, anybody in heaven's world, in any heaven's world, like, that has a reason to, like, do, eh? It is like, what was that? Like, there is nothing like insects, ants, microscopic organisms that causes one disease or the other. It can't happen. It cannot happen. It is the terrestrial that makes things like that happen. Please, let me give you the correct rendition of Genesis chapter 3, verse 17. I wouldn't only give you verse 17, you know, because I think I should give you more than one verse. I'll give you verse 17 correction. I will give you verse 18 correction as well. And I will give you also verse 19 correction. So Genesis chapter 3, verse 17, 18, and 19 correction. So they wrote it this way. Meanwhile, my topic today is, if the scorching of the sun was supposed to mean a meted out punishment for mankind, if the scorching of the sun, S-U-N, compare this to the scourging of this person they call the Son of God.
the scourging of Jesus promised. They say that he is the Son of God. So look, scourging has to do with those kind of tortures that we give to the person that is being tortured, what is called excruciating pains. They called it the scourging. Now look at what prophet said there. If the scourging of the Son, S-U-N, was supposed to mean a meted out punishment for mankind, that means what they wrote in Genesis chapter 3 verse 17, which I will read now. And unto Adam he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife, and hast eaten of the tree of which I commanded thee, saying, thou shalt not eat of it. Cursed is the ground for thy sake. In sorrow shalt thou eat of it all the days of thy life. Now see verse 18, please. See verse 18. Thorns also and thistles shall it bring forth to thee, and thou shalt eat the herb of the field. Now see verse 19. In the sweat of thy face shalt thou eat bread. In the sweat of thy face shalt thou eat bread, till thou return unto the ground. For out of it was thou taken. For dust thou art, and unto dust shalt thou return. The principal ancestor of my race is not dust. The procreator of the mankind race is not dust. If you know what this can help you learn that you shouldn't do, let me give an example of one of the things you do. What when you are lowering somebody's body down, it can be your brother, sister, father, mother, uncle, name them, friend, and you are amongst the people who can pour dust inside the very 6 feet dark grave. And you say words like dust to dust, dust to dust, and like it's over. He has gone to be with the Lord. So what about resurrection? What is the action of resurrection if the body does not matter? What is the essence of resurrection if the body does not matter? Since the ghost has gone to be with the Lord, pastor who made you, GO, general overseer, if the very person has gone to be with the Lord, what is the essence of resurrection? What is the need for resurrection? You delved into a field that you didn't know that you shouldn't have delved into. By the time you become a ghost, it will dawn on you. These things that you are hearing me say, how that truly you have made a very terrible mistake of your lifetime in this earth. You see, if the scorching of the Son was supposed to mean a meted out punishment for mankind, then my question I'm throwing to you is this: what about the solar energy benefits of today? Solar panels, aside the trees that needs the sun. For instance, you know what photosynthesis, what it is? You know how that the sun, I mean, there's such thing as solar energy. It's not only the sun helping us to see, like to have our day, and also night or evening, and then night, in terms of looking at the rotation. That's what's called the solar system. So if the sun, like this, that place, you know, like let me read it again, please. It's verse 19. They wrote it this way. In the sweat of thy face, you know, people walk and do like this. You know what I mean? They do like, because sweat is too much. They do like this. If you're living in that side of the earth that hardly see the scorching of the sun, I know you may like feel, I thought as much, because I have not really, I mean, people like we, people in my country, we don't really, really go through that kind of sweating. You know? What about people that are working? I swear today, many people are working, that is the kind of work that, in fact, when they are, where they are doing the work, they are not sweating. That's air conditioner. The place is air conditioned. They feel they are cool.
There are also people that are bad people who even become, for instance, or became political rulers at one point or the other. The likes of even Caesar, Caesar this and Caesar that. Look about that. I know that you may say, but that time there was no electronics in the earth. I'm giving an example. Caesar simply means a political ruler of that belonged to Italy. They are still political rulers today. Their place has always been the number one place when it comes to countries. Countries, you know, looking at considering where their number one citizen will stay to do the work that they expect him to do. So it should be it should be built well, you know, and furnished well. So what about that? So you say, no, we now Jesus Christ has come and has. It's not all of them that has received that. Don't forget. Are they all Christians even? So it is not right. It was not written well. I will give you the current rendition. Okay? I will give you the current rendition. Yeah, I will give you the current rendition. The current rendition is this. Genesis chapter 3, verse 17, 18, and 19. Verse 17, they wrote it this way. And unto Adam he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife, and hast eaten of the tree of which I commanded thee, saying, thou shalt not eat of it. Cursed is the ground for thy sake. In sorrow shalt thou eat of it all the days of thy life. The current rendering. And unto Lord Adam he said, unto Lord Adam. You will meet this person I'm talking about someday, if you are pure hominid. That time, I tell you, if you continue with being a non-believer of my messages, when your resurrection commences, in fact, even while you are a ghost, where ghosts go to, this voice will become so sweet. You cannot hear it anymore. You can't hear it there. Okay? But remembering this one now that you are hearing, as in the extent you followed, that's what I mean. If you are, you know, like you have issues with these messages that are coming, it will become so precious at that time. You will be asking yourself what happened to you. That you could hear this and not, it didn't ring bells to you. That's why it's called a trumpet. It's something that should get to your spirit being. Piercing through this body of yours, the soul, and then to the spirit being. Not dividing asunder anything. It just pierces. That is, it goes through the yoke, the non-magnetic field in between the soul and the spirit being that is inside, the soul with the spirit being that is inside, and the physical body you have now. In between that, like the body is terrestrial, the spirit being is celestial. The body is mortal. The spirit being in the soul is immortal. The body is natural. The spirit being and the body and in the soul is supernatural. Did you see? Tell me that this is confusing. Tell me three things I mentioned now. Natural to supernatural. The spirit being supernatural. The body natural. Mortal. And then immortal. The spirit being immortal. The body mortal. Did you see? And unto Lord Adam, like I was saying, I said that what they wrote as, Genesis 3:17. And unto Adam he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife, and hast eaten of the tree, of which I commanded thee, saying, thou shalt not eat of it. Cursed is the ground for thy sake. In sorrow shalt thou eat of it all the days of thy life. Prophet said that the current rendering is, and unto Lord Adam he said, because thou secured a consensual agreement with thy procreation partner. What they use as wife. Prophet said that God said was procreation partner. And prophet explained the word wife as is better in this earth because of matrimonial status of the Eucharist. The sacrament of the holy matrimony, which has to do with that man marrying the woman for the purpose, main purpose of raising families, which means it has to do with procreation. God sending spirit beings into bodies that are forming in the womb and they are coming. You see, it is God that gives us children. He is God that gives us these children. These children are they were spirit beings given birth to already in a certain place. Spirit beings without physical body. That was what Jesus meant when they wrote what he said as, that which is born of the spirit is spirit. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. And unto Lord Adam, he said, because thou secured a consensual agreement. You know what that means? It means Father Adam needs her consent in that matter. Apart from the spirit being. I mean, what we must have agreed in the Father's bosom. I will look unto the hills from whence cometh my help. The hills there is the Father's bosom. Prophet said that the current rendering is, I will look unto the heel of the Most Holy. The heel of this God. From whence came my origin. That's the Lord's version. Whence came my origin, where I was given birth to. Spirit being without physical body. From whence came my origin. Psalms 91. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High. That is the secret place of the Most High. Secret place because no celestial device can hack into it. Can get any video. Can catch any video of what happens there. The secret place of the Most High. Most High because it is higher than every heaven's world. You see, whosoever dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Shall abide under the incubation of the Most Holy Spirit. It is normal. We were able to stay there for some time. Why? Because we were given birth to spirit being without physical body. Nobody can stay in the very place where God is as he is with physical body. Nobody. Not because God is dangerous. It's because of God's complexion. God's, the effulgence of God's glory. God's temperature. The quality of God's physical body. The glory of God's, the glory or gloria in excelsis Deo. Gloria in excelsis Deo. The glory in the highest. That is what it means. That is what it means. Okay? And unto Lord Adam, he said, because thou secured a consensual agreement with thy procreation partner in this adventure and hast successfully altered the zoocell system of thy physical bodies as planned, comma, the action of the fall from celestial glory being an earth shaker action has affected the foundation of the earth beneath and has caused it to become terrestrial, comma, brace thou then to carry the cross of the terrestrial lifestyle you both agreed on, until thou go to where ghosts go to and wait for thy bail. This was what God wrote. I said that they wrote this way. And unto Adam he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife. The Abraham that hearkened unto the voice of his wife was the very Abraham that married Sarai. The Abram that became Abraham. That married Sarai that became Sarah. At a time he hearkened to the voice of Sarah. That was what made Hagar a mom. That was what made Hagar, I mean, being somebody who gave birth to somebody that will still point to Abraham as his biological father. Did you see? There is the Abraham of the mankind race. There is the principal ancestor of the mankind race. And unto Lord Adam he said, because thou secured a consensual agreement with thy procreation partner. I mean, prophet has explained to us before now that Mother Eve has to, that's come into that while we are in physical body, like not being under any durex. It shouldn't be. You know, like, because he's a free moral agent. There is the right of your free will agency, if I should sound that way. That same way, you know that in this kind of a planet, that's what, when it comes to you, you say, no, like this is my, what do you call it? Something human right. You see? Did you see? They call it what? Fundamental human right. You see? This is my fundamental human right. Some use words like civic right. This is my civic right. Like I have my civic responsibilities or responsibility. That's also how I have my civic rights. Fundamental human right. Simply pointing to what? The right I have as somebody that is not a slave, as somebody who is also an indigene, as a member of the country that I am in, a citizen of the country that I am in, not a slave. Did you see? What about heaven's word? You don't force people against their will. Angels are not slaves. They are free moral agents. Cherubim and seraphim are not slaves. They are free moral agents. Are you hearing that? So my point is this. That Mother Eve, knowing that the procreation in question has a price for it. There is a price for it. And it's costly. There's a cost price for procreation. And there is the Baal price for procreation. It was misunderstood. It was grossly misunderstood. You see, so like I said, what they wrote as, and unto Adam he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife, and hast eaten of the tree of which I commanded thee, saying, thou shalt not eat of it. Cursed is the ground for thy sake, and in sorrow shalt thou eat of it all the days of thy life. Prophet said that what God was talking about is the earth has become terrestrial because of this action. Not that God cursed the earth. No, he didn't. God is not wicked. It takes being wicked to do that. You see, and God is like the light, like the immaculate light in whom is no darkness at all. Selah. So the core rendering is Genesis 3, 7, verse 17. And unto Lord Adam, he said, I love this Lord before the Adam. Child, honor thy father and thy mother. Many are yet to understand the weight of it. Are you sure your mother and father are your models? Like they are role models to you? That God has to tell you this, that, and it has to do with just your biological mother and biological father. Look at it yourself. The wisdom of the third Elijah. Did you see another? I told you God commended on the wisdom of the preacher. There are people whose parents are not even of the same faith, if I put it that way, F-A-I-T-H. That means believing in the same doctrines or believing in the same God even. There are some that are of a different sect. And their children see reasons to embrace a certain way of life. What about that? That God said, say, honor thy father and thy mother, that thy days may be long. That's another. Are you sure people honoring their father, biological father and their mother, they have always lived long life in this earth? Are you sure that is true? That is how it has been. Prophet said that it is not that it was they didn't write it well. That what was referred to there has to do with the principal ancestors and the patriarchs, the fathers of the mankind race. There are the fathers of the mankind race. And God said that seeing this situation, a situation that made even the heart of the fathers to turn against their children. Turn against doesn't mean they are against the children. It means that he was turned away. That, you know, when you say be moved with compassion, they were no longer moved with compassion. When those children are being tortured, like the martyrdom of the apostles, the sacred heart of the principal ancestor, rather, of the man, was rather agonizing. Not because of what he was going through, because of their height of what? Bible illiteracy. When it comes to the truth, what the message of the kingdom is, what the message of salvation is, and so on. The height of not the attitude of ignorance. They have not the attitude of it. They didn't ignore Jesus' promise when he came. They didn't ignore John the Baptist. They were once with John the Baptist. So it's not that in that angle. But in the aspect of, that's why it's rather illiteracy. Not knowing what the truth is. There is the truth. that Jesus was referred to in this word that I want to quote now. He said, you shall know the truth. Then he added, and the truth shall set you free. There is the freedom that has to do with the bondage of religion. What made you be somebody who is porous, who can be taken advantage of by one person or the other, who is even a wolf in sheep's clothing, a harbinger of apostasy, who is somebody who is a smooth talker, eloquent speaker, sugar-coated or tongued mouth. You see, somebody who has a very good, he can express himself well enough in English, who can be such a lecturer, such a teacher, but then he's not a prophet. He was not a chosen one. God didn't give him church ministry. He dived into church ministry because he considered it a lucrative business. And because of so many lapses here and there in the Bible that suggested even that somebody can dive into church ministry because he intended to help God spread the good news. You see, so the good news needed to be spreaded. Chai. So God can call someone when he's walking on the road. God can call someone even right where he is sitting and is consuming beer in a beer parlor. God can call, send some, I mean, like calling can just come, you know. And the person can even face the people and say to them, I've seen it all. I've lived those lives. Live, you know, so things like that. Jesus Christ in the island of Patmos spoke about the seven angels of the seven churches and interpreted them. But they wrote them like he spoke to John concerning seven branches in Asia that he should write letters to. And maybe their angels may have been angel this and angel that. So every church has an angel that is in charge of that church. Prophet is explaining these things. He said that the seven angels of the churches happened to be, the first angel of the church happened to be who? Enoch. Because the people has to become, get to a certain number before you now talk about a congregation that should be also taught. And that the father Adam was still in the earth at that time. And that he was one that taught this Enoch so well that Enoch was the first that transfigured a life. Look at that. And that is what it means to get salvation. He is the first heir of salvation. That's what it means. Even though he's a patriarch. Prophet said he's also a patriarch. And he's the patriarch of the Judah tribe. Unbelievable. That the 12 sons of Jacob are not, that very people are not the patriarchs of the mankind race. It was only that God allowed it to use that to also teach concerning the 12 tribes of the mankind race. The mankind race is a race of 12 tribes. The woman in the very Revelation chapter 12 is a woman that was crowned, like they wrote, with 12 stars. You see, crowned with 12 stars. 12 stars, that was a reason. Look at you having 12 calendar months for a year. Or making a year for you. Did you see? But when it came to somebody, they've always referred to as lamb. That was a particular one they wrote. They were referring to that person. They used lamb with seven horns. Why not 12? Why seven? You see, lamb, seven horns. The woman, 12 stars. Then the sun, then clothed with the sun. And the moon under her feet. The moon under her feet. And they called that place heaven. The woman and the dragon. Revelation chapter 12. The person saw a wonder in heaven. Wonder in heaven? Wonder in heaven. The woman clothed that way. Wonder in heaven. So what happened in Genesis 3? What was it that happened in Genesis 3 that I'm explaining to you? Can't you see? Look at my reasoning. Look at my integrity. Look at my wisdom. And compare it to that person's that can speak better English than me. How could you dive into church ministry the same way people dive into one thing or the other that they out of ambition choose because they have reasons to go in that direction, but all revolves still around money. How dare you think there is no God? You think God is not existing? You fake miracles, falsify miracle, toying with the reputation. That has to do with what is so holy, what is so sacred, what is so sacred. Give words to certain angels to say regarding mankind, a race that is the race of the species of God. How dare you? You don't know what you have done to yourself. And unto Lord Adam, he said, because thou secured a consensual agreement with thy procreation partner in this adventure and has successfully altered the zoe cell system of thy physical bodies as planned. Oh, as planned. I love this. The action of the fall from celestial glory being an earth shaker action has affected the foundation of the earth beneath, you see, and has caused it to become terrestrial. Comma, brace thou then to carry the cross of the terrestrial lifestyle you both agreed on, until thou go to where ghosts go to and wait for thy bail. Verse 18, they wrote it this way. Thorns also and thistles shall it bring forth to thee, and thou shalt eat the herb of the field. Correct rendition. Thorns and thistles is what the terrestrial system breeds. Thorns and thistles is what the terrestrial system breeds, comma. The microcosms of the terrestrial are disease-causing organisms of earthborn, comma, waterborne, and airborne kinds, for which reason thou and thy children shall eat the herbs of the field. The microcosm of the terrestrial, you see, the reason, you can see walls form that thing that they call like agar, you see, spirogyra, you see that those nasty things that can be on the fungus, if I'm correct, that can be on walls, rustings. You see, the system of degeneration, the system of decay, that's better. The system of decay. That is what the terrestrial breeds. So you can understand the earth before the fall, the state it was. So you understand the reason for that terrestrial. Revelation chapter 12, the same chapter 12. That's where you get to. You see that they wrote there. I think so. The lamb slain at the foundation of this world, or at the foundation of that kind of thing. Then tell me if Jesus is permanent, was slain at the foundation of this world. This is the kind that in a law court they call it an evidence that cannot be gainsaid. That is, there is no logic you can bring about, you can bring up to make it become what you claimed it was. Why that is still called correct in the Bible you are holding now. The lamb slain at the foundation of this world. Was it when Jesus of Nazareth was slain? He was crucified on the mountain of Calvary. The earth has been before that, before the crucifixion of Jesus of Nazareth, his preeminence. What about that? Revelation chapters, like I told you, is my favorite grounds as a soldier. You see, and the things written in esoteric language that has proven to be like mysterious, I've been interpreting. You see, all of this is still to help you to understand that there was this identity theft as well, that has happened already in the earth regarding somebody that Moses spoke about, that he will come. Jesus promised when he was touching that, that was the way he went about it also. Because that very person pulled a lot, I mean, like the like when you said that somebody's eye was bugging out, you know, that kind of thing. The Luciferians, they were so threatened by prophecy surrounding that person because certain things were said that that person will achieve. And we also judge the very Babylon, simply meaning this, that Luciferians and their project, what they have been, that's in sending angels that are impure hominid angels into this earth who will come disguised. But they came for a reason. They are pursuing his purpose. They are pursuing his dream. Lucifer has a dream project. And amongst what he intended to relax with is being worshipped as God. Isaiah prophesied that. Great man of God. In Isaiah chapter 12. I mean, Isaiah chapter 14, please. Verse 12 to 14. And called him name. Isaiah called Lucifer, Lucifer. Yet Isaiah, let me leave it, please, because of time. So, like I was saying, they wrote thorns and also and thistles shall it bring forth today, and thou shalt eat the herb of the field. The God rendering is thorns and thistles is what the terrestrial system breeds. There's much more than this. That thorns and thistles is just a symbolic kind of, okay, that's what will come to make you understand how that these things that happen here, you don't find any in heaven's worlds. Okay? So just like in the parable of the sower, Jesus must interpreted thorns, the ground with thorns, as the cares of this world. That was how they wrote that. And the deceitfulness of riches. The riches, the question is that the terrestrial riches. God is very rich. The definition of wealth, is God's lifestyle. God does not know poverty. God is rich by nature. God is rich by nature. Like, not things that he has that made him rich. He is the one that brings things into tangible reality. He's the owner of the celestial planets so far. Aside, yet, he's not even ready to live in any. I'm telling people, I said, worshiping God, like we need to pray, we need to plead with God to receive our worship. How do I put it? God is not looking for worship. God is not questing for, clamoring for. God is not desiring for worship. I am telling you the truth. Let me ask you, with your think, where your thinking cap, where now? Look at it, look at this, okay? Just with your sane mind. What will your worship to God do to God? Look at it. Do you know the state or the status of God Almighty? Do you know if he really needs it from you? He will have his domain in the earth here. Like that kind of thing that happened when Moses was, you know, like that. That would be that. You know what? So that he wants people to worship him. Even if they are not seeing him physically, at least to see those stuffs. Okay? Then the best is not just this terrestrial earth, it's the heaven's world. God has not his office. He has not his office in any heaven's world. That was one of the reasons to hang planets as supernatural, to have people that are pure, to have people who are, free moral agents, you know, inhabiting different heaven's worlds. What God did to help them so much to continue worshiping him, because they will not stop worshiping him. You cannot see how heaven is and not worship the creator and bring her into tangible reality those things. I'm telling you, is to make available the person that when they see, they have seen how God looks, the image of God. Yet that person is not for worship. You don't worship that person. You can praise him, you can call him names, but you don't worship him. The person himself is the highest worshiper of the God that is his father. He will tell you, worship God. You see? I'm only telling you that the mindset of, you know, people do things like, oh God, I have done this. Now, it's like it's your own turn. You do to me, I do to you. My body is your temple. You can use me. You can use me. God lacks not body. God does not lack anything. God is all sufficient. This is one of the attributes of God Almighty. Attributes too means what you should know in terms of God's capabilities, abilities, God's virtues, God's that's how God is. God is self-sufficient, like mirror. You know how you need a mirror to see yourself? God does not need a mirror. God prosubstantiates from himself to see himself. The word that prosubstantiates, spirit being from spirit being, physical body from physical body, becomes smaller in size. The God is capital size, is bigger than the planets he hung on air, or he hangs on air, or he hanged on air. Right? The one that prosubstantiates from him is a fraction of him. Like, you don't look for that percentage in any decimal point. It's a fraction of the God. Notwithstanding, he does what God would have been doing if God had entered into a planet in his capital size. That means you don't judge by that size, like in terms of what he can do, because he's that size that goes into a heaven's world and carry out infrastructures. Is that one. Then when it comes to the most Holy Spirit, that is the same God prosubstantiated from himself, spirit being from spirit being, not involving physical body. Now that one can become many, like after that one that has come out, three will come out from that one. After that three, then four will come out from that three. That's 12. After that 12, then 12 will come out from that one. That is 144. That mode of multiplication, that method, that code of that order of multiplication, that is better. That order of multiplication is the same order of the birth of the family tree of the mankind race. Look at that. Spirit being giving birth to another spirit being. Look at that. God is like man. Man is like God. God is the father of the son of God, Adam, his eminence, who was giving birth to spirit being. I mean, look at this. You see why I say God commended my wisdom. The thing is doing something in me. That's what he's doing in me. Why? Because I could see that it entered inside me. Like there's a reflex action. Is it reflex, I will call it? Response to stimuli. You see, God knows that when it comes to me eating what he's feeding me with, that will heal me. God knows. That's what I eat. It gets to the innermost part of me. God knows. You see? So, what am I trying to say? What I'm trying to tell you, my dear, is the truth that I know. And that I know that if you follow these teachings, that I'm not deceiving you. I'm leading you towards the path that is the path that leads to life expressly. It is something you will appreciate many, many years later, much more than you are appreciating it now. I am telling you. Why did I say so? It is because the result does not show immediately. It is not an instant result stuff. It is just like the grain of mustard seed that takes a lot of time before it starts growing. I mean, before it's like that one you see in the earth, not underneath, before you begin to see that one. Yet it still has a long way to go before it gets to that way you see the size of the tree and everything that should be on that tree. It's therapeutic. It's a therapy. You see? So Genesis chapter 3 verse 18, the root is with thorns also, and this shall it bring forth to thee, and thou shalt eat the herb of the field. The correct rendering is thorns and thistles is what the terrestrial system breeds. The microcosms of the terrestrial are disease-causing organisms of earth-born, water-born, and air-born kinds, for which reason thou and thy children shall eat the herbs of the field, which the God already has made available. That is to show that he didn't take him unawares. Verse 19, the root is way. In the sweat of thy face, did you see? In the sweat of thy face shalt thou eat bread, till thou return unto the ground. For out of it was thou taken, for dust thou art, and unto dust shalt thou return. This is a notorious lie. This is a blackmail. This is not acceptable. This is a terrible blunder on the race. It's a terrible blunder on the mankind race. And on the image of God. The physical body that God coupled, the same God said that it is coupled according to his image and likeness. The image of God is not dust. The image of God is not dust. It's not dust. The component or the building material, the coupling material, the molding material that God used is not dust. God is not a clay. Potter. Or clay smith. Dust is not a genetic material. Mold with dust and mix blood or get blood and water and run inside. Put it inside the dust. Inside the dust and see if the dust will not soak it. If it will run inside dust, blood and water. He used dust. Dust, that it was dust that he used. What about the hairs? What about the hairs? The correct rendition of Genesis 3:19, which they wrote this way. In the sweat of thy face shalt thou eat bread, till thou return unto the ground. For out of it was thou taken, for dust thou art, and unto dust thou shalt return. Or unto dust shalt thou return. They call rendering. Engaging in locomotive actions or manual labor. You will experience perspiration or sweats, in cold weather, you will feel cold. In hot weather, you will feel hot. Because your body has become mortal and can now die. Therefore shalt thou eat terrestrial food until your body gradually degenerates to the point where the lifespan in her is exhausted. And then embalmed and mummified. While your ghost, after being ejected, we go to where ghosts go to and wait for your burial and resurrection. According to the logos of the God of creation. According to the laws. That one of them is the law for procreation. It was the law for procreation that demanded for that. So you don't say, why would God weave that kind of crown of thorns? Okay, you can put two and two together. Crown of thorns. No. It was a demand. It was a prize that procreation named. Like there's no other way to go about it. God will couple the physical body of the son, the spirit son he gave birth to, and that of the female version. He wouldn't begin to couple everybody's own. Mankind race has so many. Imagine how birth has been. People are still put into birth. Do you know how many people that are already where goes to go to? And birth has, people are still put into birth. Look at it yourself. They told you that within 24 hours, that was when the body was coupled. The one that is molded in the womb of your biological mother, in the womb of your wife, matrimonial wife, why didn't it? It's supposed to have taken shorter. It should have taken shorter than 9 months. I mean, shorter than 24 hours. What am I talking about? Shorter than 24 hours. Since God's own took less than, that is in the 24 hours, which is the sixth day. And the day is 24 hours per day. So the sixth day was when God not only molded the physical bodies, but the bodies of the very male and female, mankind, that's the very male, that is the mankind and his female version, but also every other thing that he had, that were the, you know, has to be. In fact, the fishes were already in the earth, the animals in the earth, the birds are already in the earth as well. You can see all the sixth day, all has to do with the sixth day. Also, Father Adam was in the very garden for some time before the physical body of Mother Eve were being coupled. Which they made like it was an afterthought. That God looked at him and said, no, it is not right. Like, it's not good that I leave him this way. Like, he will be lonely. Because God has seen animals, he called out. They just, you know. You know why? Because he commanded and they become. Light be, and there was light. So what is this person talking about? How long does it take someone to say something and he becomes? That's why it all happened within the 6 days, just within 24 hours. I understand. Carry on. Go on. Okay? You don't know why Jesus promised when he was explaining things. He will deliberately say certain things in such a way that certain people will hear and not understand. He was deliberate. Yet that is the same person that the preachers that you are one of them are telling the people that the message, in fact, the gospel is for everybody. Gospel is for all. Whosoever. You see, whosoever. You know why? Because whatsoever that is born of God overcometh the world. And that is the victory, if I'm correct. Whatsoever that is born of God, not whosoever. Like who can go for what? And what can go for who? Whatsoever that is born of God. And an example of that is you. You are born of God, son of God. And that is the victory. And how you got the victory in question is the victory that Jesus Christ got, which has to do with him dying, like they wrote, going to where ghosts go to, and defeated whatever that needed to be defeated, where you have to die first, or the body has to die first and go to. At least there is a continual journey when the body has dropped dead. And there was a fight that took place there. And there were resurrections that also happened. And they even said that graves opened, that's physical place. And also people had to go to where they laid his physical body, the one that they crucified. That is the very sepulchre of Joseph of Arimathea. And they couldn't find it anymore. That means that very resurrection has to do with physical body. And he said, hey, I am not a ghost. A ghost has no physical body like you see me have. You see that? But today, you know, he has defeated death. Therefore, that is the reason there is no longer Abraham's bosom. So anybody that dies today or that his body dies will go to be with the Lord. If the person is in Christ, he died in the Lord. You know why? In him we live. In him we move, and in him we have our being. That means you're a parasite. You're a parasite. In him you live. That's parasitic. You see that? Christ in me, the hope of glory. Ah. Christ is also in you. In him you move. In him you live. In him you have your being. And at the same time, Christ is in you. And if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. All things are passed away. Everything have become new. Hey! Assassins like it. Criminals like it. They like that message, if you don't know. Ritualists like it. Occultists like it. People that do terrible things like it. The blood is standby. The blood that cleanseth us from all sins. Wow. How be it? How be, you know? Shall we continue and see that grace may abound? Where sin is, grace is. Where there is even grace much more abound. Great. Great. It's like when you have killed and taken over the house of the person that you also killed. Wow. What a world. What a world. My goodness. I heard and I came and I saw. What a world. My goodness. What a people. What a people. Cunning. Trying to even psych themselves. Calling upon God with their lips, but their heart is far from Him. All they wanted is that can serve their basic, that's their needs at the time, at the moment. Money, 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 money. What a people. What a people. What an experience. In my journey that I will call earthly, in this land of my pilgrimage, what an experience. I will read the three verses I gave you now, and then I'll round up. I'll read it together. Genesis chapter 3, verse 17, 18, and 19, the correct version. And unto Lord Adam he said, because thou secured a consensual agreement with thy procreation partner in this adventure and has successfully altered the zoocell system of thy physical bodies as planned, the action of the fall from celestial glory, being an earth shaker action, has affected the foundation of the earth beneath and has caused it to become terrestrial. Brace thou then to carry the cross of the terrestrial lifestyle you both agreed on until thou go to where ghosts go to and wait for thy bail. Verse 18. Thorns and thistles is what the terrestrial system breeds. The microcosms of the terrestrial are disease-causing organisms of earth-borne, water-borne, and air-borne kinds. For which reason thou and thy children shall eat the herbs of the field. Verse 19. Engaging in locomotive actions or manual labor, you will experience perspiration or sweats. In cold weather, you will feel cold. In hot weather, you will feel hot. Because your body has become mortal and can now die. Therefore, shalt thou eat terrestrial food until your body gradually degenerates to the point where the lifespan in her is exhausted. And then embalmed and mummified. While your ghost, after being ejected, will go to where ghosts go to and wait for your bail and resurrection. This is what I have to share with you today. Like I said before, if the scorching of the sun was supposed to mean a meted out punishment for mankind, regarding the fact that they said, that the God said, in the sweat of thy face, in the sweat of thy face, and then when you look at it, you think of the sun, the scorching sun, especially of Africa. It's not as though it's only Africa that has that, you know. But my point is, in the sweat of shall thou eat bread. Till thou, you know, shall thou eat bread. To farm in Africa, for instance, I feel strongly that Africa defines the terrestrial better. Africa defines the terrestrial life. Just like Egypt is not Africa. Northern Africa is Egypt. And in the metamorphosis, the person who is 100% mortal is referred to as in Egypt. Why the onions of Egypt happen to be the terrestrial food in the similitudes. Like I spoke about terrestrial food here now. You see. So in terms of symbolic terms or terminologies, okay, it can be referred to as onions of Egypt. Then when it comes to the lifestyle that we have in the earth here, like bathing your body, pouring water, having to use soap because of one reason or the other. Some will even use medicated soap. Some will use antiseptic soap. Some will use just one soap or the other for one reason or the other. That is to say, even the side you are staying, the kind of, the environmental factors of that place also matters, you know, and so on. While some will use the one they call toilet soap, you see, those kind of lifestyle. Then brushing your teeth, because the teeth, in fact, if you do not, or you can wake up in the morning and you are perceiving odors from your own mouth. You see, and aside that too, there are germs that can eat into the gums that the teeth is built on. I mean, the seat is sitting on. You see, then also the lifestyle, the kind that has to do with wearing cloth that you will remove and wear another, and the cloth is external, you can tear. It was made from one thing or the other, and then you can tear, you can get dirty, you wash it, okay? You can wear it again and again and so on, and at the same time, if you remove it, you are hiding your body. You're hiding your body because you have you are an adult, you know, this kind of lifestyle. And then also the aspects of that's the ones that also has to do with like going to the restroom, you urinate or pass out urine, you pass out feces, because that has to do, you see, with the what they call the excretory system. The excretory system in it is that one. Even sweating, there are pores on the body. That is why the sweat can come out. That means the body needs that pores. You see, it's there. It can be a bit more open. Even if you have a bath with with hot water, it opens the pores. It is not that way with the supernatural body. You see, and then so that body experiences what's called perspiration. Perspiration. You see, that is because of the mortality of the very body. Just like an injury, that if you cover the injury, if you cover it so much, the injury can begin to become worse. So it needs air. You see, somehow it needs air. Apart from the treatment, it also needs air. You don't use what we cover the injury so much like that, it cannot get air. You see, what does that mean? Then the eye, you sleep, wake up, you have reasons to do like this. That is, you have to remove that thing that comes, and you see, what's that? That's a system in the eye to be able to shift dust, just something that might have been dirt that you may not know is there, or that is in the air. Like dust can be in the air, and somehow it infests the eye. So it has to shift it and bring it to where you use your hand like this and remove it. And also when you sleep for a long time, and at times you also see that you remove it. All of these things are not with this physical, but that is perfect. It is not just supernatural, it is perfect. It can't degenerate. It does not fade. Aging is not in that system in the heavens worlds. Also, where people that have that kind of physical body stays there. These are the reasons for that wedding garment. The wedding garment is that physical body that is required to be able to achieve the unism that you need for your spirit being and your physical body to become one, as in 1 + 1 = 1. That's the reason for that word wedding. The wedding garment, because the physical body of the principal ancestor of the mankind race was coupled differently. It was not given back to by God. It was coupled physically. It was coupled differently. It was who was given back to by the God is the spirit being of the very person. And God has to do it this way. Why? Because that thing they call like the subconscious or unconscious aspect of you, it doesn't work where the God is. God is in charge. He is in charge. That's why nothing takes him unawares. Secondly, the womb that physical body will form that way is the womb of a woman, not the man. God is a man. God is not a man that should. That is not true. God is a man. God is a man. He has his definite shape. He has his definite anatomy. God is a man, but not the mankind, not the kind of man that stays inside planets. Mankind, the principal ancestor of the mankind, can be called mankind as a name. That's what Adam means. And that is pointing to the very mankind, the kind of man that will stay inside the planet. That person is the son of God Almighty. If you look for the God Almighty's son, is one person. An only begotten son, who is so much a beloved son when it comes to this God. Nobody that is a better father than God. He is the most model father. No father is better than the God. He's the best father, best dad. Are you hearing me? Even as God Almighty that he is still. You see, he loved us so much. That was what enthroned us. That was what all this is. Just like somebody who finished building a house and the person wants to launch, like wants to celebrate the house. God, after giving birth, after putting to bed, in celebrating that birth, that was what inspired the logos of the God of creation. The son that he gave birth to inspired the logos of the God of creation. You see, that's why a lot revolves around the sun. That's why the other planets revolves around the sun, S-U-N, of the planet you are a part of today. You see, the planet you are part of today revolves around her axis and around the imaginary line. Which the God of creation, like somebody who lays a compass and draw a line, was the one that drew that line. It's called the orbit of the sun. O-R-B-I-T. People did not know about what is orbitual. What they know is what is obituary. When you say that, that's an obituary, they understand it. But they don't know the one that can be orbitual. Orbitual. They don't know about that. You see, what can be referred to as... Well, let me leave that. So what I'm trying to say here is this. That the three verses I gave you today, you look at it yourself on your own. Look at it and compare these verses with what you've had. I know I did not touch everything that I have to explain to you, especially when you are a first timer. I know there's a whole lot because there are still other verses in this very Genesis 3. I chose this first to bring it out today. Not that I will not touch others, but because this is the kind that some will expect that this kind I will bring it out on a Sunday service. Because they don't know that there are messages that even when they are coming out, they demand, there is a reason it should come out in that kind of a time that many people are sleeping. You see, so like I was saying, my dear, you look at this message, these revelations on your own. Look at them. Look at the content. Look at the content of this thing. Okay? And then if you've been following me, you stand better chance to, you know, like I said, it's versatile. It's versatile. It's also eye-opening. Compare if it's true. It helps you to, even some questions you would have asked that you have not yet asked, it will answer it. It helps you to understand certain things. God is not a hater of mankind. They wrote in a certain place that God said, let us confound their language so that they will scatter. Look at it yourself. Let us confound is from the word confuse. When somebody confuses people, the person can be referred to as an author of confusion. That is to devise something that will confuse people. See the word that author. God is not an author of confusion. God is not a confusionist. What happened was a miracle. Something to praise God for. Something to scream that God did. That was miraculous. That was mysterious. Look at how you learn languages today. Even babies growing, it takes them some time to learn languages. Look at you in primary school days or nursery to primary. How many years it took you before you begin to pronounce, like read what was written? Then they spoke about how that God brought like the pluralization of tongues and languages. Not only languages. These are not babies. People already in the air that are grown up. Suddenly, the language they knew that they all are speaking was taken away. Look at that. While languages were imported. Do you know what that means? The importation of these languages, what it means is that it didn't just come into the earth. It came into their mouths. Into the mouths of the people. That's what it means. Somebody speaking something that another person is not hearing. But the one speaking that is hearing that. Is that not a miracle to you? Then that way certain people are hearing a particular language. They will be communicating with each other. Certain other people that are hearing, you know, that is the same language enter their mouths. And so on. That way, then so that they will scatter. No! So that they will spread. There was what angel turned humans was trying to also do. Against the logos of the God of creation, which is that look at the earth. You can see how that there are different countries today. You can see like currencies, different currencies. People manufacturing one thing or the other. People that are buying this. People that are manufacturing another to sell also to the other people. And so all of this, why it is happening is because people have spreaded. It's because people have tried. Okay? So the Asia, You can see, like China, there are things that are good in. Then at the same time, they have their, they do them those things to sell them. They will now know where they are likely to sell their wares. The same way also in the different the other different countries or continents. They have there are things they are good in. So all of these things are encouraged. You see, the things underneath the earth that also are in different sides of the earth. So every like countries will have what they discovered that was buried, like that were in the very underneath the ground of their that belongs to their territory. And they will begin to resource that. You see, what do they call that? What? These are mineral resources. There are solid minerals and also the liquid ones. You see? And all of these things, these ones can have A and the other ones will have B. And the ones that has B, they don't have the A. They want to sell their to these other people. This and so on. All of that was what encouraged it. So God is not a confucianist. God is not scattering people. God is not is not a hater of mankind and so on. It is you people that are yet to know about the enemy that this very race incurred. Because your principal ancestor, the principal ancestor of mankind is the son that God gave birth to. An only begotten son. He is like truth personified. He wouldn't open his mouth and be lying. He will not lie concerning his identity. That was what the problem is. It built enemies. God, like God gave him a life of enviable status. It is not his fault. Beside, the revelations he was also bringing out, the things coming out from his mouth, then sieved pure hominies from impure. So the pure hominies, cherubim and seraphim, over time left the very heavens world, vacated the very heavens world. They have been tenants in, or they've been staying in, the lives of Lucifer and cohorts. Then after some time, angels that are also impure hominy kinds follow them. There is none of them now in any heavens world. They all have vacated that's the very planets where you find pure hominy angels or pure hominy cherubim and seraphim, okay? And went towards a certain direction. These things are not stories, my dear. They are not some fairy tale. I'm telling you reality, real life story. If you should transfigure today, like Elijah did, and get to the heavens world of the mankind race, you'll be so amazed. Realizing that these things, that somebody is in the earth like this, wearing mortal body, and is dividing these things, and is dispensing, explaining these things, while having the brain of the mortal body. It will excite you so much to understand much more truly what God said when he in the book of Jeremiah said, he said, you thou art my battle axe, as an axe, battle axe. Has nothing to do with being violent, has nothing to do with using axe to kill people or belonging to one occultic group or the other, and or being inspired by violence. It has to do with what this kind of thing that prophet is doing. It is a warring, is a fighting with the sword of truth. An explanation that has to do with getting revelation from the Most Holy Spirit, who will not voice it to him audibly. He gets it. Like when something is radioed into somebody's spirit. Like, so you see, so it is what you, if you do not understand it, you rather admire that, not to doubt it, not to question it. When you doubt or question it, then you become who you become. That is not, it's not good for you, because that is the God of the spirit of the prophet. You don't limit him to only having to say something to somebody audibly. That's all. Yet you have electronic devices that is already speaking that language to you. The thing you watch on your television screens, that what they told you is a device. And that is a streaming process. That's a streaming process. That is what is getting signals. That is what, you know, and so on. And you are watching that. Is that magic? Is that magic to you? What's your definition of magic? And so on. The God of the spirit of the prophets can radio a message, can send a message to the spirit of a prophet,
That was what he meant when he said to Jeremiah, "You are my battle axe." Another thing he said to him is, "Before you were born, or you were born in, or conceived in your mother's womb, I knew thee." There are those whom he foreknew that he also predestined. You are one of them, child of the kingdom. You were given birth to spirit being without physical body in the Father's bosom. That is where God is. That is the heel of, that's the very place where the God is, in his fullness. Okay? It is not what to believe in, it is reality. It is true. There is God. And God, that God loves you. These are things that will help you to know why also a lot are happening that can make you think maybe there is no God. You see, the God of the spirit of the prophets, whose revelations I'm teaching you, I am conveying to a people in this earth, whose revelations I am preaching. Whose son I am explaining to the people, that the person is his son. And the real identity of Jesus of Nazareth's permanence, also I'm explaining to the people that Jesus' permanence is much more than who the world thinks he is. That he is not the Son of God. He is the God in an incarnate manifestation, who came in the shoes of the Son of God in order to bail somebody who paid the cost price for procreation. So that one he did, he went, his ghost was the bail price. The ghost, not the blood. Why the precious blood that became a factor is the noble blood, the blood of the God Almighty himself, which was what enthroned the mankind race to become the highest when it comes to the citizens of every heaven's world. Because that life is in the God. And that life he passed to the son he gave back to, the noble blood. And that blood in question is not liquid, nor red in color. It is in the spirit being. So when it comes to abilities, in this sense, you look at what God did that the Son also can do. You look at the God, then it helps you to know what the Son would have gotten by heredity. Because like begets like. He didn't make the Son of God to be a match with God. He didn't make the Son of God to be of same height with God. Not at all. Not at all. But God is like, or the Son of God is like God. Michael means like God. Songs like, who is like God? Who is like unto thee? You should understand that the answer is, someone is like unto God. Someone is like God. And that person is Adam, his eminence. That person is the son that God gave birth to. He is like God. And he has been resurrected. He has been bailed. He is the mankind that was bailed and has been resurrected. And Jesus of Nazareth, being the God that he is, what is that place in terms of actually praising Jesus for defeating the minions of that very place? That's the God of creation. You're talking about the most Holy Ghost. When the ghost of Jesus descended into hell. And so it was less than 3 days. They say it's 3 days. You have to understand this. I mean, look at that. Friday evening. As at Thursday evening, he was already doing the things he should do to conclude well. And what happened during the Last Supper? You need to understand that turning that wine to blood, and know that he had first turned water to wine before that turning wine to blood. We have also explained that before. Now I don't have to go to now. I mean, go into it now. You know. But my point is this: that when he hung on the cross was Friday night,
I mean, when he hung on the cross and the ghost was ejected out of the body, was Friday night. Am I not correct? Then Friday night to Saturday night, one day. Your day is 24 hours. Then Friday night, certain people call that Good Friday. Friday night, he was when the ghost was ejected out. Check that Friday night to Saturday night. If it's not 24 hours, if Friday night to Saturday night is 24 hours, how is Sunday morning the third day? How is it the third day? Because they wrote that the third day he rose from the dead. There are things that I have explained to you, and I have been explaining. These are the things that will help you to understand that this is the game changer, the X factor, as far as church ministry is concerned in this earth today. I am unstoppable. I was written off. What I'm doing is not by ambition. It has nothing to do with physical body that is mortal and the brain system of that body and what, according to how life is in a planet like this, what I love the most, that I now had to make my choice in terms of profession, what I want to do. This one has to do with appointment that is divine. What has to do with my spirit being? Where that he was giving birth to, before you talk about formation of any physical body, what happened there? I was chosen. I am the seventh angel of the church. I am the third Elijah that was spoken about, the spirit of truth that will lead the church unto all truth. That person is somebody that you will talk and you hear, and you listen to that person. That person is someone that we talk, and you, that's why they wrote also concerning that person. That as he hears, he will teach. As he hears of the Father, how will the Spirit of God? They said that person is the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of God Almighty. That's the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit of God is the God in his rawest state. He is not giving that to anybody. Your spirit is not what you share. The spirit of Elijah is not what the double portion of it can come to anybody. All of those things are things in the Bible, in your Bible, that does not make any sense. You are a spirit being. Spirit being is not something that is shapeless. Spirit being, I refer to here, is the very you that has to be looked at. That if physical body should come into play, it has to be according to the anatomy of that spirit being. So you have two hands, five fingers on each, two legs, five toes on each. You were a person without the physical body. That was why if death occurs to the physical body, you still have, that is after that life. You have to continue. That means you, like knowing where you are. You can talk and the fellow ghost will hear you. Yes, it is the fact that you cannot be seen anymore here is because there are laws. This kind of a planet is in the physical realm. As it can be called by the God of creation who made it that way. So the spirit being can see you. That ghost can see the people that are still wearing mortal body. But the people wearing mortal body cannot see him anymore. Well, yeah, that people, they have their spirit beings. But because of a situation inside, which is that the spirit being and the physical body they are wearing is not yet of one element. So the life in the spirit being was hindered. It cannot flow through. Because there's a yoke, there's a non-magnetic field, there's in between that very line, the soul lines and the physical body, the physical body that is mortal. Okay? So there is the, in fact, the soul is numb, N-U-M-B, is numb. Where it is making contact, where it's supposed to make contact with the very mortal body, because of that situation. Like, so the current, the life, the current, the kind of life the spirit being has, needs a cell system that can transmit it. A cell system that can conduct it, like electricity, needs that has to be conducted by one thing or the other. That thing that can conduct electricity is what the current, that is the electric current, can flow through. If it is not a conductor of electricity, a conductor of electric current, the current cannot flow through it. That is how it is. So the life in the spirit being is not liquid. It's not liquid. It's like current. It's like electric current. It is hindered. It is blocked. You see, so the breach or contravention, better still, infringement. The infringement was what happened in the Garden of Eden. That was why it was a breaking of a law. The law is not the law of like the law that those kind of things that has to do with, you know, thou shalt not
thou shalt not steal. Not in that angle. This one has to do with a law that doesn't have to be in on any place. It's just like, for instance, somebody who flies inside the river. The river demands on its own of how you swim. How you see, because it's a different place, something like that. So the physical body in the heavens world has how it should be. So the laws of physics of that body is there. The zoo cell system, the cell system. A cell is the smallest unit of every organism. So I'm talking about supernatural organisms here. Now, the cell system of that very, the building blocks of that physical body was what was breached. It is such a difficult thing to achieve. It was such a miracle. It is something to praise Father Adam for. It was looking impossible. When it was something that he has to do. So to set the altar is one thing that if you should understand that very well. And then to bring the alteration. It was what your principal ancestor did so that you can come here. That's why you have physical body now. It was not unfortunate. You have physical body now. It is certain that you have supernatural body. Even if death occurs to that body, you will be resurrected. That physical body will be gathered again. And your ghost will be back forwarded into that physical body, and you stand up again with physical body that is supernatural. And the transfiguration of that body will happen because you were predestined, therefore can conform into the image that is the original image, the heavenly original. That is the very prototype, and that is the physical body that God coupled. If you are male, to the male body. If you are female, to the female body. The body that is the body of Mother Eve serves also as a prototype for transfiguration of every female in the mankind race. We have come to the conclusion of today's service. The years that is paramount for your growth, for your different transcends of metamorphosis. I pray that it is not short-lived. In your journey to Jericho, I pray that you are not robbed by aging. I pray that what happened to that person that the Supreme Lord Jesus Christ referred to in what is it was written as the parable of the man on his way to Jericho. I pray that that will not happen to you. This prayer is from the bottom of my heart. Without being emotional, without being compassionate, when it comes to any person in this position, somebody mediating, somebody is a priest, that is someone mediating between a people and the God, when it has to do with the people's salvation, when it comes to the matter of salvation, that's what it means to be a priest. And that is by appointment. Aaronic priesthood was founded upon error, seriously. And the one to blame on that is Moses, not Aaron. I pray from the bottom of my heart, all of you that has been following prophet, all of you that has been diligent, hearing, listening to him, all of you that has been listening to him, all of you that has been diligent in your followership. I don't mean following like a sheep. I don't mean following like you have no choice. I don't mean following like you have to be sheepish. If you know that kind of sheepish stuff, where the person looks like somebody that has lost his mind, not that kind. I mean people who are screaming because of what they are hearing, people who are responding positively,
people who are doing justice to these messages that are coming, people who appreciate this work that is ongoing, the work of restitution, and so on. People that are not off and on, people that are diligent, people that are not this way and that, people that are not hypocritical, people that truly, that their own express immortality, I mean their salvation is important too. It's truly part, it's truly like it's priority, and so on. People that are not lacking wisdom. Oh, I'm praying for you. And all of those also that are yet to come. That the God himself, who knows what before happens, amongst what he revealed, also was that there's this 144,000 people that stood out. That stood out, my goodness. That proved that what God said is possible, is possible. Where it was looking like it is absolutely impossible. Oh, I pray also for all of you. From every side of every side of this earth, where you are, prophet said a few days ago, said that the time we are now entering, like whenever it is 14th of November of every year, we seem to be shown or will be that like that's when we can begin to hear what has to do with the next year that is coming. Prophet said that is the 13th year. That's when we will do the 13th anniversary of this very church. You see, and that 13 has also a significant, spiritual significance when it comes to the foundation laying, which is the 12th. And that the 13th was what brought the alteration. And that was why the Jacob who gave birth to 12, that predetermined the tribes of Israel, also gave birth to one girl, and that girl was called Dinah. Prophet said that was because of what they call DNA. So the alteration is not a plus one exactly. It is just like when you talk about positive charge, then there's negative charge. There has to be a neutral. That neutral has also what it does. It has what you see. That you don't look down on that. Something like that. So my point is that aspect, like that is a definition, the DNA, like that is a definition, that is what will help you. So just like that map of Nigeria, you see, that there is the Y diagram. Rivers coming, rivers, Niger and Benue, and then flowing down, these two now, you see. But then, there is that soul, the soul of the matter, you see. Just like Elijah and then Moses, or Moses and Elijah on the mountain of transfiguration, there was the soul of the matter. There was this person also in the middle. Jesus Christ played that role at that time. Just like the Bible, you see. Then you talk about the law and the prophet can represent the Bible. But then there is the word, W-O-R-D. The word is what the law has to do with. Is what the prophet has to do with. You see. So like the Bible, when you open it, that is what binds the two together. That's what binds the two together. Just like the spirit, there is the body, there is the soul. You see. So what I'm trying to say here, that very year too, the 13th year, has its significance. And I expect so much after that year, after that very 13th year. And prophet said that is like when he will begin to handpick people that is now like him is the one handpicking. Picking the people that will work closely with him. This is not about being in Nigeria even. It's not about being physically in Nigeria. You can be outside Nigeria and you are doing one thing or the other with the Elijah. So it is also what he has to pray very well before he does. Because this is not like, it's slightly different from him saying, oh, God predestines and he will send them. That's a little bit different. There are the children of the kingdom that by the way God does things, okay, they will come in contact. They will come into a meeting with this transmission, with this this dispensation of revelations that has kept happening. All right, then the one I'm talking about now is just like Gideon that has to do something that is between him and his God. Say that he said that, and that is because anyone that goes with him, if that person falls by the wayside, is a reproach not to the God but to whichever, however he like the oil of apothecary, whatever he uses to ordain, whatever he uses to recruit, whatever, that's for him. He was one who called the person a soldier. You are a soldier with me. You are my squad. You are in my squad. Something like that. People that work with this prophet. As regards this project that is global, this project that is international, this global has to do with the earth as a whole. It has to do with the earth as a whole. Okay? People that are supposed to work with him and not give him vexation of spirits. People that are supposed to work with him, like they understand the vision, the very vision of the ministry. They understood him so well. What they are doing, whatever they are doing, is in line, is agreeing with what he's doing, and also his choices, and so on, things like that. Now that is supposed to start 2013. You see, selection. That's how he wrote it in his iPad. Like selection, he still call it divine selections of the people that will transfigure alive. No, I am talking about the people that work closely with the prophet. But if it takes 144,000 people to work with this very person to achieve express material alive, they are not too much. The point is that, the point is that there is something about this 2013 also that is coming. And I am happy that the Psalms, to a reasonable extent now, he has given you the last version of it. And he has made, is it ample progress, I will call it, when it comes to that's like showing you the nucleus of this gospel, showing you what you should understand that will go a long way in terms of your conviction level. You know, when the divinations of a prophet is accurate, is on point, it takes the people that are following, that received him in the name of a prophet, it takes their conviction level to that level where it cannot entertain doubt. It can't entertain doubt, and that is wonderful. When the prophecies of a prophet is inaccurate, is not good for the people following. And men didn't know that it is still possible for somebody who is truly a prophet to have prophecies or divinations that are not 100% accurate. It's still possible. There are some that I'm still doing today. I showed you some of the prophecies that, just like Ezekiel. Imagine when Ezekiel was, like what was written in Ezekiel 28. Was telling the people, mentioning names like the king of Tyros. You think there's not a place called Tyros? And the things he was explaining did not fit any human being in the earth. Prince of Tyros. What he was explaining, talking about pipes, internal beings of some, like what has to do with cherub. What fits the cherubim? Mentioning Eden. There has been in Eden, the garden of God. Lucifer has never been in Eden. The serpent that went in is a seraph. And it was the only one that went in, that is, welcome to the heaven's word of the cherubim and seraphim. No other has gone in there, except the angels, few angels, in fact, the archangels, four of them, that Father Adam taught before the fall, because he needed their assistance also. And so on, prophet has touched these things. Look at Psalm 35. Fight against them that fight against me. Take hold of shield and buckler, and stand up for my help. Prophet was asking you. So this is what you are telling God. You are telling God to take hold of shield. God also needs shield. And therefore, you are commanding God to take to even buckler. What is the meaning of buckler? And so on. You know, it's so painful. So painful. But I'm really grateful to the God who is making this happen this way. So that it will help you to know the true identity of the preacher. Because it is also a help you needed. You really, before you follow, especially somebody who is African, when it comes to according to the flesh, like they call it, look according to the biological, you see. You don't look at him and see anything special, anything supernatural based on what you see that will help you to know, oh, this person is outstanding. This person is, you know, even though the Immaculate Conception, when he came, still they couldn't even voice out. I mean, say the things that are true in terms of what they saw. Well, what they saw, the Immaculate Conception, what do you expect that person to have looked like? I'm referring to Jesus of Nazareth's permanence. But look at what they didn't even write his hairstyle. They didn't even write the way his fashion is. They rather wrote that John the Baptist do dress with animal skin. But I tell you that Jesus of Nazareth's permanence is such a personage. Such a personage. You see, well, like I said, we have come to the conclusion of today's life transmission. And my prayer is heart felt. I'm truly praying for all of you, those that are yet to come, that are pure hominids, heirs of salvation, who are yet to come, that are being occupied in their minds, chasing or pursuing one thing or the other. Some may have been even praying. Oh God, I know that something is wrong somewhere. Oh God, I'm not so encouraged if I look at how the situation is, looking at different churches and also different voices. Oh God, help me. Oh God, guide me. Oh God, hear my prayer. You see, I pray that this God who hears prayers and answers them according to his plan, his will, according to the revelations also that was revealed, that you can find some of which in the Bible you have now. I mean, some in the Bible that you have now, which has to do with like 144,000 people. Approximately, I said approximately because traditionally, the Bible counts on men, not the women. So prophet said, it's supposed to be 144,000 male and 144,000 female. Because one thing is certain, the exact number in the male wing, the exact number in the female wing. Else, the 144,000 will be divided into two. I pray for all the children of the kingdom in the different sides of the earth. I pray from the bottom of my heart, oh God of our salvation, the God who had predestined all that he foreknew, everyone that will come into this earth that belongs to the pure hominid mankind, pure hominids that are in the very mankind race, the God that loves the son he gave birth to so much that he has to celebrate the birth this way. He went this far even to pay a price that was called bait price, to come and be and come and in the size that is his baby body size, on the palm, on the hands of a 13-year-old girl. He went to that extent and grew gradually until he was 30 and so on. Oh God, the evidence of your love I can see. You made it that the angels, the cherubim and seraphim can see the image, that's the way God looks, the exact way God looks in a certain size as one of the citizens of a heaven's world that they can come to, that they can watch activities in that heaven's world on their celestial devices and so on. Oh God, I pray that your perfect will concerning us, the children of Adam, his eminence, the children of your son, concerning us, that be what prevails. To intercede for the gross, the height of blasphemy, how much we have misrepresented the oracle of God, how much that the names of God that are so holy, how much that has suffered in this earth. The image of the God also, how much that has suffered in this earth is not what is easy for me, because I feel that can make even the law wish me to test what it looks like to go through that, since I can delve into, like standing in the gap to intercede for what I may not have exactly, I mean, no, given a good, like when it comes to, you know, the weight or gravity of an offense, a proportion of offense, even though I can call one global, global proportion, does not mean that this kind I'm talking about, this one I'm talking about, that has to do with the names of God, what the names of God has been through. The God that is spotless, most immaculate, his son, which if there's nothing that could have been at stake, at least that same word, image of God. Image of God. The God there is capital G. Why the Son of God, the person that is the Son of God, is small g. You see? So the image of the God Almighty is the Son of God. In a planet, in terms of planets, that's when it comes from somebody inside the planet, that is exactly the way God looks. Oh God, I am not pleading for forgiveness because I know that matter is too high for me to just jump into that. Lest I look like somebody who says something because they say that talk is cheap. But I'm praying, oh God, that these ones, the heirs of salvation, whom you foreknew. I know that the passion I have in this work that I'm doing cannot be compared to thine. And I'm not claiming in any way to be someone who is desirous of their salvation, who is passionate about their salvation more than the God. Not at all. But I'm doing what I'm supposed to do as somebody who is like that person they can see today, to follow. Someone that is leading a people towards a direction that's supposed to land them to a destination is supposed to be visible. Because the people needs to see the person that they are following. Else it looks like people that are shadow boxing. Oh God, I pray. All of them, male and female, that are supposed to be transfigured alive, that are supposed to be immortalized alive by me, by this revelation that I come in. Oh God, I pray that not any of them will I miss, that not any of them will I miss. Oh God of my salvation, I pray that thy perfect will concerning their health also, concerning their health also, be what prevails. This I pray in the matchless name of our Supreme Lord Jesus Christ, Reverence. Amen. Before we round up with the prayers we have always said when we're rounding up, I know that I have announced this last service day, which was the very organ of this year. That's the program we have always held every 1st of October. Okay? And I know also that you know that I said that today, being the 5th of October, if I'm correct, is the birthday of one of Prophet's biological daughters by the name Princess Anita Ocheze Alexander. And like I explained before, Ocheze means throne in English. She is not the throne that anybody will sit on, not in that angle. It is pointing to the fact that an eater of revelations, an eater of divine messages, wins that throne, which is the physical body, that is the temple, that is the ideal, that is the bride, the temple that the spirit being marries and they become one, that the hand of the body becomes the hand of the spirit
the physical body of the spirit. The hand, the leg of the body becomes the physical leg of the spirit, as though the spirit has known before, something like that. Okay, that's just the unison between that anita and that throne, so you understand that. And prophet said also that that child, when that child came, one of the revelations that God gave me regarding her, like I said, that when I want to call names, I have always loved it. I'm not just calling them because I like the way it sounds or the meaning, but there's a revelation with it that comes with it. Now that is pointing to like a child representing the truth, all of you that are an eater of my revelations, an eater of divine Eucharist, you see. And that is the reason, like the church, we did our 12th year anniversary this year. She is being 12 this year, you see. We will do 13th year anniversary next year, 2024. She will also be 24, be 13 that year, okay, and so on. So she's not the only biological daughter of the prophet, but I mean each of them has revelations with that came with them. That's my point. The first Elijah has no biological children in the earth. The second Elijah has no biological children in the earth. They didn't even delve into what's called matrimony. I understood that perfectly well. I understood it perfectly well. And also, the third Elijah, there is a way he's supposed to go about it. And that is what is happening. That's what is happening. So all of these things are supposed to be understood, well understood by you. So that you also, when it comes to this, like what we're doing today, you will do what is, I can refer to as the needful. Normally, because I am your leader, okay, you are supposed to revere me to that extent where my biological children, I don't have to tell you or remind you, to celebrate them as supposed. Like I celebrate you as well. I celebrate your birth my own way. You see, that person's birthday, believe you me, that is not what I take. Your birthdays, there are words you may not know. I prefer saying them at that day. That very bad, it's your second birth. You are born again in the earth here. It was a second birth. Just that it's not yet complete. When it's completed, your spirit being and that physical body becomes one. Your first birth was the birth of the spirit being you. You see? So my point is that, just like, for instance, 1st October, that we celebrated first, we had that program, right? But that very date, that 1st October, there are words I will say concerning the country I am in. That day is the best for me to do that. Not because that was the day that country was born. No. It was the day of her independence. Very true. There is the one that if I... Let me leave that, please. My point is this. That we should... Okay? Or you, in celebrating this child, you are expected by me to send messages. Send, like, your wishes or prayers, okay, to her. And then... those of you that can call, the number you call should be on your screen, or you should know the number to call to talk with her. If there was not so much a call, then you text her. Some of you to do text to me, which is still good. I do show her. Okay, that is supposed to be so. All right, and then Sunday, that's this coming Sunday, we will celebrate her as a church. The God of the prophet, whose revelations you endorsed when you receive these revelations that are coming. Whose prophet you received when you received me. May he continue to protect your interest in this earth. This is another prayer from me. In the matchless name of our Supreme Lord Jesus Christ, I pray this prayer. Amen. So, we will say the prayers for transfiguration, consecration, and the grace. Then we round up. And if you have any complaint or comment regarding the clarity of our broadcast or transmission, audio and video wise, especially from all of you watching from outside Nigeria, please email to askprophetobinna@gmail.com. at gmail.com, not .org, .com. So, We will now say the prayers for transfiguration, consecration, and the grace. So we round up. O temple most holy, O temple divine, is thy body, O God, indestructible, immortal body, tangible yet invincible, incorruptible in nature and holiness, fearful and overwhelming in glory, indescribable in size, most precious in substance and beauty, neither made nor begotten, I stand in awe and humble admiration of thee. Please make our body, our physical body, our mortal body, to become or migrate or conform to the perfect prototype of thine expressly. In the matchless name of our Supreme Lord Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Prayer for consecration. My head is the temple of divine wisdom. My tongue is the pen of a ready writer. The word of God, which is the sword of the spirit, is in my heart and in my mouth. The shield of the word of God. The shield then that the word of God can give, the fortification that the word of God can give, is in my hand. My heart bears the soul and possesses the mind of Christ. I belong to the prophetic presbytery. The grace in fellowship, the grace of our Supreme Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet fellowship of the Most Holy Spirit remain with us now and forevermore. Surely, immortality plus incorruptibility follow us all the days of our lives as we dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. In the matchless name of our Supreme Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Until I see you again, or you watch me on your screen again, continue to swim or bask in euphoria of positive metamorphosis. And don't forget that this is the game changer, the X factor, as far as church ministry is concerned in this earth today. Therefore, brace. Welcome to Rabbi Class. This is not in any way a Jewish-oriented arrangement or initiative, as it may have sounded to you, but a midweek church service with an interactive session that can graduate to a debate kind of symposium that will accommodate even rival religious sects. This is that messenger that has a lot of explanations, a lot of answers to unanswered questions, that can reap, that can harvest souls of pure humanity in different sects, in different religious sects. But the kingdom of God is something that if you have not understood that, you wouldn't even know the difference between the kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven. It is bone-cracking, it is meat-busting, it is truly rabbinical. Well, I will counsel you not to miss the episodes, as they are epochal and eye-opening.